Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
It is Wednesday, the 21st day of November 2012. I am your host, Alex Jones, and we are going to be here live for the next 3 hours. The founder and head of WorldNetDaily will be joining us, Joseph Farah, in the second hour today to give us his take on what he sees as the biggest threats to liberty, but also some of the positive things he sees unfolding. Always a very informative and enlightening talk, and he'll be joining us today for an hour, Joseph Farah. In the first and second hour, obviously, there is a cornucopia, a veritable plethora, a galaxy of important news that we will attempt to at least go over in some detail. And I also intend to open the phones up and take your calls. We will get into that coming up in the next segment. I will give you the number. Obviously, the Middle East situation is continuing to deteriorate. And whereas I've said that it's wrong that Israel's using high-tech weapons to devastate large swaths of the Gaza Strip, it is also out of control when the Palestinian Authority celebrates suicide bombings and rockets killing people. I mean, just from a PR perspective, it's like when Hillary says, "We came to Libya, we saw he died," or when people make jokes about killing. I mean, even if you're going to kill, it is very unsavory to brag about it, even when you personally have done the killing. Taking human life is a very solemn act, but it's all part of this globalist disconnect from reality with the corrupt elite that we have in control. Bus bomb rocks Tel Aviv amid push for Israel-Gaza truce. And that's just some of the news and information we have on that front today. You know, I talked to Watson a couple days ago and asked him to do an article, and he's going to do one soon. But anybody can pull this up. Israel actually founded Hamas in 1973. That's Haaretz, Jerusalem Post, UPI. You can pull those up and read that for yourself. Just type Israel founded Hamas into a search engine. You can get the mainstream news on that. Just like our government funded and created Al-Qaeda. And just like our criminal governments led Al-Qaeda into Libya, Syria, and other areas, part of what Wesley Clark broke down. See, there's a Wall Street Journal headline, "How Israel Helped to Spawn Hamas." That's kind of a spin. No, they founded it. They actually set it up as a counterbalance to Hezbollah, as a divide and conquer, the Iranian manipulated group. But Iran wasn't in control of Hezbollah at that time. So I guess it was mainly, if I go back from memory, it was a counterbalance to the PLO, the Palestinian Liberation Organization. Again, there's just too much news happening, too much unfolding right now to not be here on air on the day before Thanksgiving. And if I sound a little bit slow, I only get sick every couple of years, and I had a little 24-hour bug, and I've still got it. But I am here. But I just want you to know why I sound a little bit different. It's actually kind of purgative, if that's a word, to get a 24-hour bug. Kind of cleans you out, if you know what I mean. Okay, we've got so much news. I am going to break down when we come back. Huge developments on the TSA front as free humanity strikes back against the dog-training tyranny of the TSA, the economy, and more. It's all coming up. It is Wednesday, the 21st day of November 2012. I'm Alex Jones, your host, and we have Joseph Farah of WorldNetDaily joining us in the second hour to talk about the agenda of Barack Obama. You know, I read the articles they wrote. It confirmed my own analysis. And I got to tell you, everything that Joseph Farah and others said that Obama was planning in his next 4 years is certainly, unfortunately, being proven true. In fact, and then some. Never underestimate the activities of a group of control freaks who've been given basically unlimited governmental power to dominate the population. Never underestimate what they'll do. Never underestimate hiring a bunch of minimum wage employees, giving them a 2-week training course and telling them that they can read minds and that everyone is a potential terrorist. Of course, they'll go from 9,000 employees 11 years ago to 70 plus thousand today. Of course, the TSA would end up being on our highways, in our schools, at our shopping malls, and changing the entire culture, certifying police and security guards, waving a magic government wand and telling them they can suddenly stick their hands down your pants. I've sat back and watched the body language of TSA flying, and you can see the low-level ones are just there for a job and look extremely depressed. But then there's those in the mid-level and upper-level management who are crazed with a petty will to power. They don't have the mind. They don't have the IQ. They don't have the heart, the history, the research, the blood to be a leader on their own among men and women by what they produce and what they stand for. But within the larger structure of a parasitic, authoritarian, eugenics-based social engineering system, they swim freely like amoebas in a fetid cesspit, amoebas in a sewer-filled swamp. And this is their day. This is their season. And the season is just beginning. The season of wickedness, the season of darkness, the season of oppression, the season of injustice and humiliation and sickness and pain and poverty, everything bad replacing everything that was good. Because as due process and the Bill of Rights and the Constitution and the defense of liberty, as that exits, the vacuum is filled with the most abhorrent. Because you're not just going to get some median level corruption. That too will be displaced. In fact, all of the out of control abuse we see right now and that we think can't get any worse and gets worse every day, the good is exiting the chamber, out the vent, out into space, by the global propaganda machine that acts like a fan blowing it out. Into that comes corruption, oppression, mercenaries, control freaks, and dupes. But as the chamber gets filled with that, it will still continue. The tyranny will still continue to be intensified, blowing that out until the most corrupt, the most wicked, the most cunning fills the space. And then they will turn off the propaganda machine. They will close the little trap door, and it will be a contained space that is known in literature and in all cultures as hell, living hell. If you've studied North Korea for the last 55, 60 years, it can only be described as a living hell, even for the 1% of the population that's the inner Communist Party. If you study the Soviet Union under Lenin, Mao, Khrushchev, and others, it can only be described as a living hell. If you studied Nazi Germany, once it bloomed into 1939, 1940, it can only be described as a living hell. If you study Cuba, it can only be described as a living hell. If you study any of these places where the tyrants get into control, it is a living hell. And the tyrants themselves generally end up being paranoid, sequestered up in their little ivory towers themselves in a hell of their and their cohort's creation. Okay, what's coming up today? We've got quite a bit of new reports that have stacked up this week because we're not doing an original nightly news every night because it's a holiday week. We're using that to finish some of the new studios and put in some of the new equipment and do some training. But still, they produce news pieces, and these are excellent. There's an interview that David Knight did that I want to interview, that I want to play, an interview he did, had a Freudian slip. I want to interview this gentleman as well. I've interviewed him before. House Bill 80, Texas Freedom Travel Act, which would make it an offense to touch someone's private parts as a condition to enter a venue or travel, also prohibits separating a child from his or her parent, which the perv forces like to do. Because if you can train a mammal to give up its youth to an obviously predatory person you don't know, you've broken the will to survive. You've broken the most basic instinct to defend the youth. Because there's only, people have that basic survival instinct individually. That's the most powerful instinct. And then I'm starting at the end of the equation. The most powerful instinct is to protect your young. That's number one. Number two is to protect yourself. And number three is procreation. That's why they say sex sells. The holy act, that's why we're so attracted to it. It's the creation of a new life form, a splicing, a 50-50 genetic clone of two people. It's kind of a big deal. But the system always seeks to lower it down and debase it and make it a petty act. Because if you make it a petty act and not something that is the greatest thing in all of creation, you can then debase the entire flow of the life force and the chain of life itself. And I'm not judging anybody out there. In my day, I was quite promiscuous. The point is that I now understand these things. And as you become a man, you set aside the things of a child or as an adolescent. And I'm just trying to tell people things so you can miss out on some of the things that some of us have unfortunately not missed out on. And you may sit there and say, I'm sure it's terrible. You're missing out on all that. I know a lot of rock stars, for whatever reason, big ones, and they'll tell you that it's destructive. And side issue. The problem is getting into things is everything is interconnected, and I have thousands of points I want to make, and my thought process runs about 100 times faster or more than my verbal capabilities do. But look, it's called common sense, but it's not so common in an age of disinformation and poisoned minds. A festering culture. But the point is, we'll get to his interview with that state representative that has introduced that Simpson. So that is going to be coming up later in this hour. And then I've got a bunch of other reports here on carbon taxes. I've got one on secession and some others. So we're going to be airing some reports here. Some of them will be premiering here on the radio today. Now, that said, I do want to open the phones up. And we will do that on any issue you'd like to raise here on air. And I'll do that now. You know what? I'll do it after the break because I think it's best that I at least mention some of the news that we have here that I will attempt as best I can to get to today. Boy, I didn't think I'd ever see the drudgereport.com trifecta, but three Infowars.com articles up at drudgereport.com. And I know why the articles were on drudgereport.com. Sometimes I'll see an article right when it breaks and I'll go, oh, out of 100,000 articles out today, I know that'll be on Drudge because Drudge knows from a populist perspective what people are interested in because it's what he's interested in. That's what governs what I cover. But I think it's interesting. You're going to hear it covered here, but three articles. Children being expelled in San Antonio for not wearing RFID tracker chips around their necks. And two other articles that also got into the TSA activities. So we're going to be getting into those reports here today. And the Rutherford Institute has taken up the San Antonio family that we've been championing, the Hernandez family. And they're in court today. So after Thanksgiving, we'll undoubtedly maybe get an update on Friday when Mike Adams is going to be sitting in here. Get an update from them on that situation. But I do have some newscast on that that we're going to play some clips of here today as well. And we have a big stack of TSA tyranny here. They're, as usual, going over and above what I could even imagine they would do. And then here's another article that's up at drudgereport.com today. Cameras inside mannequins now spying on shoppers because they want to get the cameras down at ground level. And it's all part of creeping you out, again, breaking your will. Also, on the economic front, a very important stack of news on what's happening with the engineered financial cliff. And then bus bomb rocks Tel Aviv amid push for Israel-Gaza truce. Again, how do you pick a side in this when both sides are killing each other? And why did the Palestinians start firing rockets a month ago? I mean, why did they invite this attack? Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We're headed into Thanksgiving, and I'll tell you what I'm thankful for. I thank the God of the universe for creating this universe and for giving me the great gift of consciousness and life and steering me through all the trials and tribulations of my 38 years, about to be 39 years, upon this planet, and successfully protecting me so far and my family so that I might grow and develop. Because more and more I realize one of the greatest sins of the New World Order is trying to shutter people's development, trying to dumb them down so they never find the beginnings of their true human potential. And I'm very thankful for our forebears, our founding fathers, and the women who supported them and their families for the great vision they had and the great time bombs they prepared for corrupt tyrants of the future. The First Amendment, the Fourth Amendment, the Tenth Amendment, the Ninth Amendment, the Second Amendment, that simply point out in unalienable, unalienable rights that were there from the foundations of our world. Because it's hard, once you have basic liberty established, to get people to give up that liberty. It recoils against being enslaved. That's why tyrants the last few thousand years, when they first take over a central government, they haven't taken over the general population yet. They always create a new police corps of thugs, control freaks, petty clerks, nobodies. William the Conqueror, who invented the modern, what is the modern property tax? I don't know. How many years ago was it? 1,100 years ago? Not 1,100, 800 years ago? I was flipping the numbers. It was like 1,100. But you look up the date of William the Conqueror's takeover of England. The point is, he brought in the property tax. And then he set up his own new paramilitary enforcer. There were more than 50,000, because I have the history of the property tax right over here in my little hand. There were over 50,000 different private landowners in what is just England. Not Scotland, not Ireland, but just what is England. And by the time he died, there were only a couple hundred. Yeah, 1066, but by 1100, he took over in 1066, and by the time he died, a little after 1100, They had gone in purposefully and destroyed the economy, brought in a blight. You see, taxes are the power to destroy. They're designed to destroy middle-class infrastructure. They don't want you uppity. You see, state of Texas last year got a little uppity when the House of Representatives in the state I live in, the state I hail from, unanimously voted to say, look, we have existing laws that police can't touch your genitals. We're going to enforce this, a felony on the inside of the pants, a misdemeanor on the outside. We're going to order the state police into the airports. The feds are power grabbing. These aren't even sworn officers on top of it. They shouldn't be called officers. There's a federal bill to try to make them stop calling themselves officers. Because an officer means you hold an office under the state or under the government. In the past, if you were a federal officer, you had to be commissioned by Congress. They weren't about to just let the president start appointing who he wanted, because the president might appoint a bunch of his men to do a William the Conqueror. See, we've been through this over and over again. We live 75 years on average, and if we forget history, we repeat the same thing. We do the same things over and over and over again. And now we've got tyrants who write books about how they do the same thing over and over again, and how they're scientifically trying to bring something in that can't ever be defeated. But then the feds threatened an armed blockade of the state if it passed the Senate, so they killed it. But here it is. TSA reportedly exposed breast Representative Ralph Hall's teen grandniece, called it accidental. Update, TSA integral internal report released, blames girl's loose-fitting dress. It's her fault. Maybe that's why I have three articles here of TSA people being arrested or convicted this week for child porn. When you see a good-looking woman going through the line or a little girl, it's like wolves seeing a bloodied lamb.
We're on the march.
Police in Texas try to stop the Texas Youth Commission running public raperariums for the children the state had grabbed. Oh, then they weren't able to stop that. They were ordered to stand down. Or when big mega banks steal trillions of dollars in my state, they don't do anything. No, what they do is they go out and raise revenue for the state, which is then promptly sent overseas to mega banks to then come back and buy the politicians out. Okay, let me hit a few more news stories, but then I'm going to take your calls. And again, we have a bunch of special reports we're going to be airing today. We are live. The toll-free number to join us is 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231, on any issue you'd like to discuss, wide open telephones. But, you know, sometimes I get up here on air and I'm sarcastic. I say, isn't it great the tyrannical government's taking it over? Be sure and take lots of vaccines. Be sure and drink lots of sodium fluoride. Let's have the tyranny come in and let the government, you know, rape our wives. Yes, it's great. Let's eat GMO and get big, fat, juicy tumors. And then I see emails that come into the office and people are tuning in going, well, that's terrible. Why is he saying that? It's called being flippant. It's called being catty. It's called sarcasm. 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 Darren McBreen and Rob Dew finished the Satan Speaks little video I did, in the tradition of Goethe that he wrote in the, I don't know, 1830s or so, Faust, which I need to reread. And in the spirit of the Screwtape letters that were written by C.S. Lewis, which I'd never read. When I was a child, my dad would drive me to school, and a few mornings a week, he would play books on cassette tape. And so I listened to the Screwtape letters, but didn't even know that C.S. Lewis had written them, or they're going to make a movie out of it. But it's the devil, or it's a high-level demon talking to one of his mid-level demons. And, man, I was just rereading that last night. Well, I'd listened to it, but I was rereading it for the first time, physically reading it. It's just amazing the knowledge that C.S. Lewis had about how real evil works. Whether you believe in a physical manifestation of the devil or not, I just did a one-take deal where the devil is talking to his son. And it's so frightening sounding that I realized that the public is so dumbed down now, I can't even put it out like this. People won't even understand it. They'll think I'm literally worshiping Satan and that I want the... No. The real devil wants to act like it loves you and it's a nanny state and there's nothing really concrete in the world and why don't you go along to get along and everything's nice. Or for those that do have a side of flair to them, that the devil is adventure and the devil is power and the devil is you know, a gorgeous woman. No, God gave us gorgeous women. God gave us handsome men and daring men and loving mothers. That's creation. That's life. A beautiful woman. So incredibly gorgeous. Their eyes, their eyelashes, their hair, the curve of their shoulders, their breasts, their waist, their hips, their legs, their feet, all of it. That is life. That is a creation. That is not the devil. That does not come from the devil. That does not come from hell. Rotting stench is what comes from death, and I don't want any part of it. And I'm going to say this. The globalists love to get people into wars because out of wars, they can corrupt societies. And they can consolidate the power and the wealth because people will get in line during wars. As many a tyrant has said, war is the health of the state. But it's more than that for these social engineers. That's why they have wars on illiteracy. Illiteracy gets worse. Wars on drugs. More drugs flow in because they run the drugs. It's a full spectrum dominance. They bring it in. People sell their bodies. People rob their houses, rob your house to buy the drugs at 100 times what they should cost. Then that's laundered through the big banks. Then if they catch low levels using it, they put you in the prison to go to college to learn to run more criminal operations run by the banks as well. Then the general public gets scared of the giant armies of criminals and calls for a larger army to handle it, which is then more police and more bureaucrats and more judges who then prosecute wars against the general public and who put you in jail for 6 years for washing your car in your own lawn or leaving dog poop on the hike and bike trail. See, it's all actuaried, angled out. And it's not just my opinion. The globalists write countless books and white papers bragging. And so many times I read their white papers, and I come in here on air and source them and show them to you. But I know that 99% of you, probably more, don't even go read them. If you just read it, you'd know how serious this is. Because the globalists have realized how humans work. They study us like an ornithologist would study birds. Or a zoologist would study, you know, just the keeping of animals in general. And they talk about us like they're animals, and the elite consider themselves to be a different species. No, you're not a different species in the way you say that you're missing your heart and your love and your compassion. And the higher wisdom that what you do unto others will come back on you. There is no escaping it. There is no escaping it. There is no escaping. You reap what you sow. Karma, what comes around goes around. Everyone inherently knows this. And God fear, not I'm God fearing, what I call God fear, isn't that you're afraid of God. It's that you're afraid of violating the true, wholesome, good order, the chain of life. You inherently know that it's bad to hurt a child. But you don't not hurt a child because it's some sin you're holding back from. You abhor it if someone points out that even that type of idea exists. That's God-fearing. And so much of the modern giggling evil is a let the devil take it all. I don't care what's going on. I don't care what's happening. I don't care what it does to other people. I don't even care if I'm destroyed myself. I'm going to go out and I'm going to have a good time. And then those people invariably die when they're 25, 30 years old. They invariably are completely unhappy and they leave a train of destruction behind them. The higher level globalists, though, they are conscious of all this, but they are so desirous to destroy the mass of humanity that they actually try to take care of themselves as best they can so that they can achieve the goal of hurting more people. Because that, for them, is the ultimate act of creation and power. It is a monument to their beauty as they see it. And they are very threatened by the pure. They are very threatened by the good. They are threatened by beauty. They are threatened by innocence. It is like a bright light to cockroaches. And they are playing God. I mean, it is the ultimate fallacy and off the chart hilarity, if it wasn't so serious, the most butt-backwards thing I could imagine, that the people running the dominant environmental religion movement are the ones accelerating the nanotech takeover, the cross-species genetic manipulation, and literally hundreds of other abominations. Because they are driving it from an abomination perspective. You see, you can say, let's have a collectivist, utopian, altruistic, directed, social engineered system to lift up humanity. But I use this analogy 100 times. I'll use it the 101st. It'd be like Gandalf in Lord of the Rings trying to use the ring for good. But it would turn to bad. But we're not at the point of a big, giant government that could go bad. It has been scientifically evil for at least 85 years in the central hubs of the scientific tyranny and has now metastasized out and is a full-grown man. It is now in its prime, lifting the axe above the republic. I mean, it is red level, we're under attack, it's on. And the beginning is now here. Everything we've seen previous was like a kitten playing with a mouse. It's not a kitten anymore. It's a saber-toothed cat coming down on us. And I'll go to your phone calls, and I have all these reports coming up in Joseph Farah. It's just that we better be thankful for what's good, because evil is not being able to recognize wholesomeness from spoilage. And the system seeks to disease our minds so that we might be destroyed. Because if your mind is not diseased physically and spiritually and mentally, its programming is to resist this and to do everything in its power to stop it. Now, I do have all the news here, and I'll bring some of this up with Joseph Farah, but I got into this latest talk, this latest line of discussion, this latest slow-motion tirade, talking about war, because you look at what the Israelis are doing and how they've been dehumanized and how their government controls the media and how they're a big welfare state and a collectivist state and a police state surrounded by big barbed wire walls. And then the Palestinians pushed out in their own areas. They become their own police state. And why Why did the Palestinians on October 24th fire 80 rockets into Israel? Or when they're after the ceasefire, Palestinians launch mortar shell. The 28th, Palestinians fire two rockets, two Grad missiles striking four schools. October 29th, Palestinians fire 20 rockets and mortar shells in Israel. October 30th, Palestinians for the first time use 45 km rockets to fire into Israel. Palestinians fire two Qassem rockets. November 4th, Palestinians fire a Qassem rocket into Israel. November 6th, following the shooting of a Gazan civilian approaching the border with Israel, Palestinians fire a rocket. November 9th, Palestinians fire two Qassem rockets. November 10th, Palestinian militants fire anti-tank missile at an IDF jeep patrolling the border. Palestinians then fire 25 rockets. IDF airstrikes destroyed several Palestinian targets. November 11th, Gazan groups fire 100 rockets and mortar shells at Israel cities and towns. November 12th, Gazan gunmen fire 9 rockets at southern Israel. November 14th, Israel targets Hamas leader. Gaza gunmen fired 9 rockets. And it goes on. You see, here's the problem with all the reporting I'm seeing on what's happening in Israel. Either it's one-sided to Israel or it's one-sided to the Palestinians, and both sides are vitriolic. But I notice, because I don't control what my writers, you know, do, I mean, they're people I hire that I know have good heads on their shoulders and I respect, that our reporting is probably 90% pro-Palestinian. And I called a few of my writers yesterday and I said, look, we can be against the bombing of these civilians and killing them, but some of these articles we're posting don't even talk about the fact that the Palestinians are breaking the ceasefire. And my issue is we need to go full spectrum on this and explain that Israel created Hamas in 1973 and that our government created Al-Qaeda and that our government's put the Muslim Brotherhood in everywhere now to then support this new escalation. Who stands to gain from getting both sides to kill each other? Because that's what'll really end this, is the full spectrum realization that the military-industrial complex wants to keep these wars going. And that it's wrong when we had Ray McGovern on, it's, you know, wrong when he talked about, he's right to bring it up, you know, that in a Pentagon meeting, they're saying, let's mow the grass, dehumanizing the Palestinians like that. He's right, that's wrong. But it's also wrong when I go to these Palestinian sites and I see them and they say Jews aren't human and Jews are the devil. And I mean, you know, I was on a site this morning just by accident that showed me as a goblin Jew and then had all these Jews with big giant noses like Hitler cartoons. And the weird thing is I'm not Jewish. But if I was, I'd be proud of it. But the point is, the reason I get into this is that it's so mentally ill. And if the Palestinians wanted spokespeople, it probably shouldn't be the lowest of the low Nazis living in their mother's basements. Because that's what I'm saying. I don't like what Israel does, and I criticize Israel. And Israel has race laws where you can be arrested if you marry someone who's Jewish, if you're a worker there. I mean, that's some serious stuff that should be talked about. And instead, it's almost got to be on purpose. I mean, I know Hal Turner was a government agent, and I said that I could prove that, but you can't prove it with all of them. But most of them are either government agents or they're snowballs. You know, they're repeating what they heard. They're mockingbirds. You know, snowball gets bigger. Because the anti-Israel propaganda is so nasty and so ham-fisted that it makes Israel look good, and it makes you, even if you've been a critic of some of the things Israel does, go, well, I'm sure not going to be with these people. I'm sure not going to. But again, that's what war does. And my point is that there's a lot of hypocrisy here. Israel's full of hypocrisy. Palestinian governments are full of hypocrisy. And why doesn't Egypt let in the Palestinians? Most of them want to leave. I mean, why not? Why doesn't Jordan do that? Why didn't Syria? Why doesn't Lebanon? Well, the truth is, all those governments need that fight to continue so they can keep people at each other's throats and point at each other as the bad guys for their military-industrial complexes. Ladies and gentlemen, we're live. We've got loaded phone lines here. I'll take calls in this segment, the next. And Joseph Farah is joining us, but we'll continue with calls. And then coming up, we're going to get into the economic news, which I've got to get to today. It's so important what's happening. Also, the Italian Supreme Court president calls for a new 9/11 investigation, an international criminal court, into the fact that that's an inside job. Former Italian president's gone public saying that they were briefed that it was an inside job. Of course it was, by the criminal elements that run our government today. Mike in California, listening on KOMY 1340 AM. You are on the air, sir.
Thank you, Alex, for taking my call. Hey, Alex, that last segment really spot on with the analysis over in the Middle East. I would encourage your writers to maybe even listen to that segment for a future food for thought for some of their emphasis in their articles. I wanted to comment on yesterday's program. I didn't get to listen to it in its entirety, but about this next from now to in the next 3 years, that being a real key point for if there's any possibility of the American spirit to have a chance to take back some or preserve some freedom and liberty, that it's... We better get it up right now and do what we need to do.
Well, that's my point. I mean, I'm not calling for people to follow my plan to restore the republic. I'm saying it is up to the states, Declaration of Independence. It's not even what you call secession. The states created the federal government. We've got to move through the states to block the TSA. If the states have to control the borders, then they have to do it. It's their right to defense if the hijacked feds won't do it. And we have to get aggressive about this, and it's a process. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen overnight. But let me tell you, my call, some would call it a clarion call, war cry, as one writer called it, is to get people to realize we're being conquered by collectivism right now. Collectivism bankrupts you with regulations on purpose, exempts the insiders so they can dominate and be the only ones that exist in the artificial economic ecosystem. And then they come in with collectivism, siphoning off the tiny middle class that's left until it's gone. Then once they have a giant mass of poor people, they tell them, go live in cardboard boxes. And then there'll be paramilitary police to mow them down if they get in the way of that. And then whatever's left of the middle class will be protected along with the elite by the paramilitary troops and will beg for the paramilitary troops to mow down the cardboard box people because the middle class would have had their firearms taken. You disarm them, you take their jobs, you bankrupt them. It's called enslavement. Go ahead.
That leads me to my next comment. Now, there's a lot of talk about secession. I know that you guys carry the documentary in your store, Nullification or Rightful Remedy. I'm actually going to watch an airing of that locally tonight, where some people are coming together to watch Nullification or
Rightful
Remedy.
That was made right here in Austin. It's extremely professional, and it's something that everybody should see.
Yeah, I believe it's important. Now, you mentioned about Ron Paul and putting up there. I agree with him being instrumental, but my attention keeps on going back to the Achilles heel of emphasizing one man instead of a...
No, I agree. Ron Paul needs to come out, which he's done. I don't want to get into inside baseball, but I've spoken with Ron Paul. I've spoken with his crew. Yeah, he's got... I've spoken to his people. He's got three big unannounced projects that are about to be announced that are big, that he's committed to. But they are looking at what we're talking about and trying to make that a focal point. And if we can keep Jesse Benton out of it or Jack Hunter, we should be okay. According to them, the Bilderberg Group's great people, literally. But that attempted coup d'etat inside the Paul organization has been routed. All right, we'll be right back. Stay with us.
Jones.
We are continuing with your phone calls. We'll take some for Joseph Farah. Didn't matter if you called him before. He can speak about any issues. We'll go to people when he's on with us as well. Steve and others, you're up next. Steve in Illinois, listening on WWCR Global Shortwave. Welcome, Steve. How may I serve you on this day before Thanksgiving?
I got hey, Alex.
What kind of dog is that?
It's a Yorkie, and he's driving me crazy. Alex, I got to ask you, do you know what brought Castro, Hitler, Putin, et cetera, to power? the internal stranglehold of their economies. You know, one has to ask, you always hear about Hitler. Well, why Hitler? Why was he brought in? And, you know, the same thing, and Putin come in and said, oh, no, not in this lifetime are we going to be having this take place after Yeltsin, after Gorbachev sold out to the West. That's exactly what was going on. And you talk about the Palestinians. I've had to grow a thicker skin over the years, by the way. I've been doing this for 32 years, trying to shout from the mountaintops what's going on day and night, nighttime talk shows and everything. But, you know, you ask about the Palestinians and Israelis. We love Israel. It's Israel leaders we hate. Just like in this country, we hate our leaders.
Exactly. Our media always spins it and says, you hate America. You don't like the government. No, no, no. I love my country. I hate my out-of-control, illegitimate government. And exactly, my only issue is both sides are killing each other. It's wrong. But the government stay in power because of the constant state of war. I'm just saying the pulling back and the not taking sides is what brings clarity to this. That's what I'm saying.
Yes, but it's the chicken and egg theory. Which came first? Who's subjugating who into abject poverty right next door? They're actually cousins. I follow Messiah.
No, I got it. So you're saying the Palestinians have a right to revolt because they were the ones herded out and pushed out through tribal warfare.
That and the way they're being forced to be led around by the nose today. We couldn't stand what they're doing. They got 12-year-old kids that stand sentry at different checkpoints. They got to go through all day and ready to blow their heads off. A 12-year-old kid telling them what to do, grown people, and that. And Alex, you know, I'm sorry for the
situation. Well, no, I'll say this. This is my biggest problem with what's happening in Israel. It is true that a lot of the Israeli advisors are the ones over here training our police, and so we're like turning into that over here. No, it's bad. I mean, listen, I'm just so sick of it. And I'm so sick of hearing about it all day too. And I was making the point about the anti-Israel crew is cartoonish, and I think sometimes that's on purpose to make anybody critical of what Israel's doing look like buffoons. I mean, have you seen how almost every site is now governed by whoever's the most radical online? And so it's literally like Nazi propaganda now. And people telling me how Hitler was good. I studied history, real history. Hitler was an absolute out-of-control lunatic. And so my whole issue is, you know, it's like either Iran's good or the U.S. is bad, or the U.S. is good and Iran's bad. No, they're all corrupt governments. The point is, you're right. Our government's the one that overthrew their legitimate government in 53 that was pro-America. And it's true. The West goes around backing the overthrows of different places to take them over. Go ahead.
Well, let me close with this. You know, it's not coincidental that we just happen to be involving all these countries and killing them right and left. The Christians and the Muslims are all getting killed in that. And who benefits from that? And we're being the big bully boy for Israel, using our military and everything. And that's exactly what's going on. I think Israel, the AIPAC and everything, has got a hold of our military.
There's no doubt that the special interest AIPAC's up there at the top and is in there manipulating, and that's wrong. And this whole Petraeus thing and the rest of it is probably a part of that manipulation. I hear you. We're going to go to break and come back with Joseph Farah straight ahead. I'm Alex Jones. Ladies and gentlemen, we are joined here on the Alex Jones Show. That's yours truly, by Joseph Farah, the founder of the Western Journalism Center, also been a newspaper editor at some of the biggest papers in the country. And, of course, he's headed up WorldNetDaily since 1996, one of the biggest constitutional libertarian websites out there. Well, the biggest, if you don't count something like Infowars.com or DrudgeReport.com. And all the books, they publish countless books, just a real force out there. And I wanted to get him on. He's a hard guy to get on, but here he is for his take on the election, because he had said before the election that constitutionalist libertarians might get run out of the country if Obama got reelected. And, you know, 4 years ago, he hadn't backed McCain against Obama. He wrote the book None of the Above, a bestseller. But now Obama told us what he was going to do, coming after semi-auto handguns and rifles. Wants to shut down over 1,000 power plants. They shut down 200 plus, and it crippled us already. I mean, we've got the whole agenda, and now it's here and it's on. And we are in grave, grave trouble. Not that Mitt Romney was great either, but the vote for Obama, and now they say a mandate. Conservatives, you better get more socialist than Mao Zedong and Lenin and Karl Marx combined, or you're not going to win. Well, that's a hoax. We know that the numbers vary, but 12 to 15 to 18 million people that would have voted Republican because of the way Ron Paul was treated and other things, and we've seen serious numbers proving that, they just didn't vote. And so now the argument is, hey, sometimes it's good to get that 105 fever and really, you know, kill whatever's in you, that virus or that bacteria. Well, now it's here. So we better use this tyranny to wake people up, states' rights movement, lawsuits, exposure, or it's over. Because once you get a pure democracy and you get 51% that can vote away the money of the other 49, you go into a hardcore tyranny. Now, of course, the mega banks, the offshore folks are lobbying for this because they can then get all their corporate welfare as long as they've got a giant group. In fact, I have an article here. I want to go over some of it later. It was up yesterday, the American Dream blog. We had it up at Infowars.com. Government website for immigrants. Come to America and take advantage of the free stuff. The Daily Caller also reported on it. WorldNetDaily.com also reported on it. Welcome to USA.gov. And we've got copies of what it advertises here. To get all your free welfare, come here, have your babies for free, get everything free, 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 and then let you vote fraudulently to take, well, Alex Jones's guns and raise my property taxes. You know, my house value has gone down quite a bit. The state says, we're not going to let you contest that, and it's going to go up. And they pass a new property tax to build stuff for the University of Texas that's got close to $100 billion or more. You heard me right, $100 billion. There will be fewer jobs for American workers under this, of course. It'll drive down the wages and create a new voting bloc. So this is it. They're conquering us through collectivism. The ultra-rich using the poor. This is the old pattern. Steve Shank uses the analogy of Scar in The Lion King. I saw The Lion King like 10 years ago and never made this point on air, but it's true. He goes to the scavengers, the hyenas, and he says, hey, help me overpower the lions. Make them our slaves, make them hunt for us, and you'll never go hungry again. So they do that, and they go and they take over. And that's what's happening here, and it's all just going into hyperspeed here. There's a Senate bill set to vote that's called the Internet Privacy Rights Bill that actually says no more warrants, period, for anything. I mean, it's all happening right now. It's totally insane. And we face just unbelievable times. This is not hyperbole, folks. I have to have talks every week with my wife. Because as a mother, you know, my wife's smart, but as a mother, the basic instinct is to protect your children. I got three children. And she's lived around the world. She's got a degree in history. She knows. She's lived in Europe, you name it. And she says, man, we know where this goes. We better get out of here. And I'm like, nope, nowhere to run. We're going down with the ship. And she's like, okay. But I mean, that's not hyperbole. We have to have this discussion now, you know, like 6:30 in the morning, at least once a week, seems to be when it happens, you know, when the kids are still asleep and you're looking at them asleep in bed. That's when... Again, I'm not staying here to be the big radio star. I'm not staying here to do all this. I could go overseas and do my show. I could go to Switzerland right now, folks. But you're not going to get away from the New World Order with activity like that. Joseph Farah, WorldNetDaily.com, WND.com. I'm just kind of having a public display here of what I'm really feeling and intellectually seeing. Where are you with this whole election and just the fact that... It's not just that we have the socialism, the federalization, the police state gear up, the EPA announcing 6 years in prison for dog poop in your backyard, mainstream news, 6 years in prison for soap running off your car when you wash it, nothing to do with the environment, just total control, the nanny state, the giant prisons being built everywhere, the police bugging their eyes out everywhere. I mean, where do you see this going, Joseph Farah?
Well, I agree with your entire analysis. Couldn't agree more. I would raise one other issue that you didn't touch on, and I don't know if you've touched on it since the election, Alex, and that is that I think one of the things we learned from this vote was that it's not even a legitimate vote. I mean, quite honestly, when
you look at all of the shenanigans involved in it, I think the vote was stolen. I think it was stolen probably because of the, you know, new voting patterns we have, the new machines.
Now, I knew, just interrupt, then I'll shut up. I knew you were going to go there without even knowing where you'd go first. That's why I left that out. And again, you know I'm nonpartisan, so are you. Mm-hmm. They even Bev Harris, who's been a Democrat, the top expert, she said, well, I mean, go over the anomalies. They're not anomalies. They announced states before any votes were counted. There were precincts with zero votes for Romney with thousands voting. I mean, it's a fraud.
Absolutely. And it starts before the election because, you know, I think we talked about this perhaps the last time I was on. I mean, these voting machines where there's no paper trail anymore, where, you know, a little alteration in the software can effectively change the vote, negate a vote, and so forth. We saw evidence of that, but just days before the election, you know, they were testing machines, and they found that people who voted for Romney, their vote was turned into a vote for Obama and so forth. And, you know, most people probably thought, oh, well, they'll get those bugs worked out before Election Day. But on Election Day, one of the guys in Chicago who had discovered this problem, he's actually working on the machine. He went in and voted for Romney, and he saw his vote changed to Obama, and he brings it to the attention of the poll worker, and he's told, "Well, you should just assume that your vote was recorded correctly." Now, you know, I don't know about you, Alex, or people listening to us right now, but, you know, I actually want to see my vote recorded the way I cast it. And that's just one of literally dozens and dozens of anomalies. You know, before the election, as you know, we were very concerned at WND about foreign contributions making their way into the Obama campaign. It had happened in 2008. There were no consequences for it, no prosecutions whatsoever. This is strictly illegal. Foreigners cannot contribute to U.S. elections. That's the law. Well, it happened in 2008. We documented it. And in 2012, we decided to test the system to see if there had been any reforms. We made donations to Obama's campaign on his website using a Pakistani IP address and using the name Osama bin Laden.
Saw that.
Occupation deceased terrorist. And his employer, Al-Qaeda. He lived at 9/11 Jihad Way someplace in California. We had to use a U.S. zip code because you have to put that in. And we raised every possible red flag you could raise to get this donation disqualified. We really didn't want Obama to take our money, but he took it. And he took it again and again, several donations made by Osama bin Laden. We then started, you know, some other, who else can we have donate? We had Ahmadinejad donate, Hugo Chavez, all kinds of people, every single one of these donate. And again, all using foreign IP addresses, which should be a total giveaway. I mean, you've got a website, I've got a website, I've been in this business for over 15 years, and I can tell you the easiest thing to detect is an IP address. And if you know, it's not against the law for me to sell things to foreigners, but if it was, I can block every single foreigner from buying anything at WND, which is exactly what you would expect a campaign to do, a presidential campaign, but they didn't. In other words, they were encouraging foreign donations. Now, we got a lot of publicity about that. Did they give the money back? No. They still haven't given the money back. So we filed an FEC complaint with these very specific examples, and even that, and that's been made public. Obama campaign knows about that. Did they give the money back? No. Now, at some point, I expect the money will be returned, but there'll be no penalty. There'll be no, you know, major investigation. There'll be no scandal. And I believe that this is the tip of the iceberg in terms. Now, let me give you an example of why this is a big deal. Obama bragged about the fact that, you know, what a high percentage of donors gave $200 or less.
I'll tell you what, Joseph, stay there. We got to go to break. I don't want to cut you off here. When we come back, get into this, but yes, just like Fast and Furious didn't get in trouble, just like Solyndra didn't get in trouble.
There's no consequence.
They can't give the money back because that would set a precedent for all the other, and so you could have Satan, you know, giving him $1 million from Hades, and that would be the end of it. So this is basically what's happening. They're just setting the precedent to do whatever they want. Joseph Farah is our guest. I'm Alex Jones. We'll be right back with Vote Fraud. It is the day before Thanksgiving, and we are live, and I know we've got callers on hold. You'll get to talk to Joseph Farah coming up, and myself with your comments or questions about the world. I've got some news items I want to throw at Joseph, but I want to get his take, because, you know, he's a smart guy. You know, he's saying we're in trouble, and I mean, I agree, they're bringing in a very serious tyranny. We've launched the whole TSA opt-out and filmed them. That's really been successful, a testament to the public being angry. Bipartisan success, by the way. You got even big Democrat sites getting behind it. People are sick of it. We're going to talk about that coming up, too. I want to salute all of you that have been involved. Got a bunch of special reports we're going to be airing as well. This is a short segment, long segment coming up. Joseph Farah, head of WorldNetDaily.com. I cut you off. You were getting into election fraud and the evidence of it. Listen, I had Bev Harris on, who's always very judicial, very judicious, and we're having her back on. But she said in blackboxvoting.org, that it's hands down, absolutely beyond fraud, where, and she had to admit, she's been a Democrat in the past, she said that it was states where Romney should have won, they announced it for Obama before the polls even closed, and that there was just unmitigated fraud off the charts this time, where now they don't even try to hide it. But go ahead and make the point you were making.
Yeah, well, I was talking about the $200 donations. You know, Obama brags about most of his donations were $200 or less. But interestingly, he has his campaign refused to release the records of the $200 donors. And so here's what you do. You know the way they spread wealth around, right? I mean, government money, you know, their billionaire friends. What is to prevent the money from being spread out to people and they're instructed to make donations of $200 or less? We have no record of those people. It's unbelievable. So, that's just, you know, there's so many ways one of the things that kills me, the Democrats, you know, they're so much against voter suppression. That's why they want to have photo ID laws where people have to, you know, actually show who they are when they vote. These are the people, by the way, want to put chips in you and want to identify every move you make. But yet when it comes time to voting, a legitimate time to ask somebody for ID, all of a sudden, it's voter suppression if you ask somebody for voter ID. And in every state that required photo ID, Obama lost. Okay? That should tell you something about why voter ID.
So we've got to put voter ID in.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I mean, gosh, you got to drive a car, you got to have photo ID. You get on an airplane, you got to have photo ID. You go banking, you got to have photo ID. These are understandable things. There's a lot of fraud out there. Why is it that there's no fraud at the election booth? I mean, it's crazy to think about. This is supposed to be...
Well, also, look at how all the scientific polls had them neck and neck or Romney a little bit ahead. Again, but just for the sake of, you know, debate, let's say people really did elect him. Mm-hmm. What do you think of how they're pushing it? It's a mandate now for collectivism. The Republicans better become collectivist or they're out of the game forever. They're trying to move the Overton window, you know, towards total Sovietization.
Yeah, well, you know, the Republicans are in, you know, they're in CYA mode right now. They're already capitulating to everything that Obama wants. John Boehner, the House Speaker, you know, he's gonna raise the debt limit again. He's gonna let Obama spend as much money as he wants.
More taxes. Well, that's because the mega banks want that money. That's why they're capitulating.
Yep, it is unbelievable. Look, I predicted, you know, virtually I predicted doomsday on your show before the election, and this is what we're facing right now. You know, that's not to say I want people to give up the fight any more than I want Alex Jones or I intend to give up the fight. But we really have our backs to the wall. The next 4 years are going to be very, very ugly. We need to be prepared for it. We need to, you know, encourage each other, stick together, people who believe in the Constitution and the founding principles of this country, we need to stick together more than ever before.
Absolutely.
And I still believe there's a chance we can eventually turn this thing around. Maybe we need this tyranny, Alex, to wake people up in this country. Maybe they haven't experienced enough tyranny in the last 4 years. Maybe they got to see it on overdrive. And if they do, and we're lucky, people are going to rise up in anger and righteous anger and take this country back.
This was a short segment, long one coming up, but I want to get into your ideas of how to turn things around and look at some of the places we've had some success. Are there any bright linings out there that you see other than the fact that sometimes it needs to get really bad first?
Yeah, the old expression, the darkest hour is just before the dawn. I don't think we've reached the darkest hour yet. I think the darkest hour is coming sometime in the next 4 years in this country, and hopefully that means...
Exactly. Let's talk about, from your deep research and the books you've published on this, what the attack plan's going to be. Give us a heads up, Joseph Farah, straight ahead. Joseph Farah is our guest. He heads up WorldNet Daily. And thanks to Joseph, we know about the Bilderberg Group. He's been one of the people out there reporting on it for 16, 17 years. And so many other issues, defending the Second Amendment, you name it, and trying to influence the Republican Party to not be complete globalists. But, you know, Joseph, I want to go through a bunch of questions down here for you before we go to calls. But that's my big issue here, is the Republicans aren't really going after them now on Fast and Furious. They're not going after them on Solyndra. They're not going after him on, they're giving in on the tax increases. They're doing everything because we know the big special interests that put Obama in. That's what they want. It's the ultra rich that are running this thing against the middle class. But, I mean, we could see the Republicans go after Obama for all the outlandish things he's done and kind of check this out of control executive power. Instead, I've got articles here where the Senate's saying, hey, we're just going to get rid of the Fourth Amendment entirely.
Convinced that it's not going to happen. We're not going to see Republicans, even though, for instance, the Republican House, the House is under the control of the Republicans for one reason, the Tea Party movement in 2010. And these guys have contempt for the Tea Party movement that put them in power and are going to do everything to ignore, what the Tea Party asked them to do. And John Boehner is tripping over himself to accommodate Obama in every way imaginable. So we don't have a two-party system at work in Washington, even though we should, because, the House of Representatives is a very, very powerful body. That's the body under the Constitution where all spending is initiated. That's a body that, before you can raise the debt limit, they've got to approve of it. Republicans have a majority in there. In other words, they could stop all of this. In one vote, Alex, the Republicans in the House have the power to return us to something resembling constitutionally limited government overnight. And they're not going to do it. They had chances to do it in 2011. They didn't do it. They didn't do it in 2012. And in a few weeks, they're going to vote again, and they're going to give Obama all the money he needs to continue Obamacare and all these crazy stimulus programs and redistribution of wealth up the wazoo. So do we have a two-party system in this country? No, not effectively, we don't. We got a one-party system.
That's right, and I've now seen in hundreds of papers, I know you've seen this as well because you track the news as a news hound just like we do with your great team up there. So I visited your offices, amazing crew, and set up. You've got hundreds of articles the last month with mainline Republicans in the newspapers criticizing state house and congressional members who are talking about Agenda 21 and the UN running our military now. I mean, that's in congressional hearings that NATO is telling the Congress what to do, and that Congress now has just handed over and all of its authority on the power of the purse. And then meanwhile, the Republican Party is still busy trying to run a witch hunt against mainline conservatives that have woken up to what's happening, thanks to you and DrudgeReport.com and some of the other sites and people that are covering issues like this. It's just so frustrating that this should be our greatest hour. When the world government's been announced, we've been confirmed to be right. It's run by mega banks that run derivatives, the Federal Reserve. And now America can wake up and we can take the states back and take the federal government back and restore the republic.
If you know what's going on, it's actually funny to listen to the Republican establishment types making excuses about the election, because to them, it's the fault of conservatives that this happened. Now, they went ahead and they nominated the most liberal guy they could imagine, Mitt Romney, right? They picked, most of the Senate candidates. They didn't get their way on one guy, Todd Akin. So Todd Akin, to them, is responsible for the entire election debacle. And now what they want to do is they want to make sure that the people don't get to choose in primaries anymore who the candidates are. They want to pick them themselves, which they did anyway for the most part, but not 100%. This is what I'm seeing from the Republican Party right now, and it's very, very scary, because you know you have to have some balance. You got to have some opposition. You got to have checks and balances, as our founding fathers knew all so well, and we don't have them anymore.
Exactly. The Republicans operate like this placeholder of like, oh, there's conservatism. And then meanwhile, it allows the left to move even further towards tyranny. And then they go, oh, we lost because we didn't, you know.
We weren't liberal enough.
Do you agree with me looking at the numbers that it was Ron Paul people sitting it out? That, I mean, that was fraud as well.
Well, you know, hey, did Romney lift a finger to enlist Ron Paul and his, you know, did he give them the time of day?
No.
And that was a huge mistake, because Ron Paul showed in the 2012 primaries that he was, you know, represented a lot of people out there. And that was a tremendous, you know, I don't know, oversight, what do you want to call it? It was arrogance that they had no place else to go. Well, they did have some place to go. They could stay home. And that's what they did. I mean, if somebody told you a day before the election, Alex, that Barack Obama was going to get 10 million fewer votes than he got in 2008, what would your prediction have been about the outcome?
It would be that he would have lost.
Exactly. But Romney got 3 million votes less than John McCain got, which was almost unimaginable.
No. What happened is a giant mass of Republicans that understand the Republican Party is a fraud and working with the Democrats stood down. And I talked to these people. They said, let it get bad. I got my guns. They want a civil war. Come and get it. And I think that's what it's coming down to. And that brings me to my next point. I don't want the media to be able to frame this as secession, you know, because we want to set up the South again or something. I mean, the Declaration of Independence says the states created the federal government. They can abolish it or remake it or change it or abridge it whenever they see fit. So why not have the states pull out, have another constitutional meeting to not bring in new dangerous, you know, a constitution or a con, but to re-upload the Bill of Rights and Constitution and declare this federal government illegitimate. I mean, I think if we got that word out, I've talked to a lot of Ron Paul supporters, his advisors, Edwin Vieira, Bruce Fine, of course, also Lou Rockwell, they said what I'm talking about is actually in the Constitution, Bill of Rights, Declaration of Independence. And, of course, I mean, I know it's there, but they concurred that it's a good idea. Well, I'm just going with the founder's idea. It's not my idea. It's not my plan. I'm saying it's my plan now to get everybody to have a large debate and kind of turbocharge the nullification movement, like we see Texas unanimously voting to kick the TSA out last year. Mm-hmm. The Senate killed it. Then David Dewhurst, though, got shot down in the Senate because he helped kill it last year. They're back with the bill again. I mean, what do you say to my idea of packaging, repackaging secession the way it was really meant to be, that, hey, if the federal government goes rogue, the states get together and remove it?
100% for it. I've been for it for years, talked about it many times. Walter Williams is another guy who's talked about it eloquently for years. And, you know, I think it's coming down to that. I do believe we've got such a stratified society right now. I mean, you look at the electoral map, and that doesn't even begin to tell the story. But you basically have, you know, urban areas versus rural areas. And, you know, the people who live, have chosen to live in the rural areas are people who want to be self-governing individuals. They don't want to be messed with. They don't want people telling them what to do. The people who love government have all flocked to the cities. And unfortunately, there's more population in the cities than there is throughout the rest of the country. That's why the map looks so weird, you know, that the that Obama can win, even though he's got, you know, it looks like just pockets. Few pockets around the country of support. And so what we got to do is we got to continue, even if we can find one state to make a stand. I don't know whether it's Texas or South Carolina or North Carolina, some state where we can flock there and we can build that, you know, shining city on a hill. And you know, other people will want to come there. Good people will want to flock there. They'll want to be living in a society where, you know, you earned what you deserve to earn, and you're not taxed. But I mean, we've got to do away with the IRS, and we've got to do, you know, that means a complete break with Washington. And I don't know if, you know, we've got enough courage to do that today, if enough people have enough courage to do it. But really, what alternative do we have?
Well, that's all the globalists, as you know, talk about, is so-called tax avoidance havens. The U.S., because we only pay 50-something in, you know, federal, some form of federal tax and all the different hidden taxes. But you look at France, where it's over 70, close to 80%. You know, the French government calls Britain a tax avoidance haven when they've got when they've got VAT. But it's a fact. Government knows that when you cut taxes, tax revenues increase, just like Kennedy did. He cut one tax bracket by 50%, the other by 30, and tax revenues doubled by the next year. So why do they want to keep increasing taxes? Because it's about control.
That's
and
right.
Then they get to give that tax money and contracts to themselves, and they're not going to stop. And I just see their entire battle plan built around stopping a secession movement. That's why it's obviously the key.
And that's why they love borrowing, too, because there's no accountability to borrowing. You know, you start raising taxes and people start getting angry. But if you borrow money, people don't feel it coming out of their pocket. You know, we haven't had the inflationary cycle that we all anticipated with this crazy borrowing that's been going on, unprecedented. And so, you know, we're going to see this continue now for four more years. But by the time Obama's done, we're going to be looking at somewhere between probably around $25 trillion in debt at this current rate. It's unthinkable.
Which is great for the big foreign mega banks because it's all zeros and ones.
Yeah, it's just digits. It's just electronic digits. It's amazing.
But when you don't pay your property tax, they come and take your house. But then I get to read the federal websites where they tell the illegals, come here and have a kid for free, and we'll put them on welfare. And once you're here, your whole family. It's like, wow, if I don't pay my property tax, which is really hard to pay, it's not my property. It's a rental fee.
Mm-hmm.
Then they come take my house. But nobody cares about me, but, oh, the government advertises in foreign lands to come here so I can pay for their life.
Well, you asked about, you know, what's coming in this with this second term of Obama. And I'll tell you one of the first things that's coming, and it's due to the total capitulation, once again, of John Boehner and the leadership of the Republicans, is we're now going to see that comprehensive immigration reform that we've been hearing about for, you know, two administrations of Bush and one administration of Obama. Now there's a consensus in Washington. Boehner, who used to be against this when Bush was for it, is now saying, yes, we got to do that. We're going to do it right away. And, you know, he's doing it because he genuinely believes that they, you know, because they lose the Hispanic vote, the Republicans do.
And the media can spin it because it's all about identity politics where people, well, I'm voting for Obama because I'm black, he's black. How is it good for Hispanic Americans to have their wages knocked down, to have their kids saddled with debt? But the media says this is what Hispanics want, so it becomes that bandwagon effect. It's just unbelievable.
Maybe we should all move to Mexico. You know, it's a beautiful country, great beaches, natural resources, take over Mexico might be easier than taking over the United States of America.
That might be good. Exactly. Yeah, but they got laws against that there.
And they got guns and drug cartels. And
yeah, we're in deep trouble. I mean, it's so crazy that all of this is going on. I want to take some calls here, but what are some of the other things you see front and center on the radar?
Well, very big story in WND today. I don't know if you had a chance to see it yet. It's called Now Big Brother is Really Watching You, and it's about DARPA. But this is an aspect of DARPA. I know you've talked a lot about this. DARPA is now working in the realm of artificial intelligence. You remember the film Minority Report?
Pre-crime.
Pre-crime unit, yeah. DARPA is on the verge of achieving that, the pre-crime unit. They're going to be able to, you know, if you watch the TV show Person of Interest, you see it there. That's what the machine does. It was built to predict, you know, where the next terrorist attack was going to come from, but it predicts a lot of other things.
And, of course, they'll then stage something to claim it's infallible, and it's like the Zeitgeist movement wants a computer that decides what we all get in a collectivist system. Well, who programs the computer? Just like, you know, other stuff's been proven a fraud, like they plant DNA on people, they've mm-hmm. been caught doing everything else. The lie detector's been proven a fraud. I mean, this stuff can't be trusted.
No, of course not. Trust machines? I mean, it's crazy, but you got to read this story by Steve Elwert. Very good, very scary, but yet, you know, you want to know what we're going to be up against in the next few years. This is another thing. I mean, this is going to make Orwell look like child's play by comparison.
And they're not just going to use your neighbor tattling on you because they're mad at you to get a visit. They're building little NSA private hubs everywhere with these little spy bases all over the country, and then these giant facilities in Utah and Texas. And basically, for those of you that like collectivism, get this through your heads. This is a collectivism with an architecture towards oppression. I mean, collectivism always goes that way to begin with, but this is consciously going that way.
And you remember, if you go back and you look at the worst tyrannies of the 20th century, Stalin, Hitler, Mao, etc., you know, one of the things they did back then when they didn't have the technological capability that we have today is they just indoctrinated the kids. And kids turned in their parents. That was what they were trained to do. And, you know, we're very close to that right now with the indoctrination of the public school system. It is a statist system, and the kids are being turned away from their parents. I got to tell you out there, all you parents, you know, one of the very first things you need to do, if you haven't already done it, is get your kids out of the state school system.
I agree. By the way, for at least 15 years, they have ATF-sponsored local sheriff's deputies that 6th and 7th grade teach the kids for a semester, and they have, quote, access on the playground and lunch, and they write essays on what their parents do. And we've got school computers watching people at home. And now in California and other states, as you know, Joseph, they're giving kids inoculations without parental consent. So it's already there. I mean, if you have
inoculations and chips, you see the story today in WND about the girl's about to be suspended from school because she will not accept a microchip in her student ID. And they're going to, you know, attempt to throw her out of school.
Oh, yeah, they gave her the suspension letter. In fact, we're going to have the Hernandez family on Friday after Thanksgiving when Mike Adams is sitting in. They couldn't come on today because they're in the court hearing. Absolutely. We're going to take a few calls in this segment, then 5 minutes into the next hour with Joseph Farah. And then we're going to continue with your calls and a bunch of special reports in the third hour here today. I'm Alex Jones of InfoWars.com. Stay with us.
Have you ever wanted to generate your own supply of electricity?
Joseph Farah is our guest for two more short segments. I can keep saying this 100 different ways, but folks, if you've studied mainline history, you know how much trouble we're in. I mean, there's no doubt about this prognosis. But like, if you came into the doctor and you had giant tumors the size of, you know, grapefruits all over you, I mean, you know, they tell you you're in deep trouble. This country's in trouble. And you've got hardworking people that are holding it together and then a bunch of spoiled, rotten, surly punks. And I don't mean just poor welfare people. A lot of them are disabled or, you know, were brought up in it. I'm talking about the yuppies and the so-called liberals. They're not even liberals. I want to make a film or write a book about my observations. They're these anti-human, evil-loving, gibbering trendies. Joseph Farah, what do you call those people? I know you've run into them that just think corruption and the state is cool, and they think they're part of the system, so they get this reflected glory from it, and they giggle at anybody that's concerned. What do you call those people?
I don't know what you call them, but do you remember the movie The Matrix?
Yes.
You know, I think an awful lot of America is living in The Matrix, you know, and then there's a few people like you and me and Drudge, and maybe, you know, lots of people, other talk radio guys who are living outside the Matrix. And it's so hard for us to figure out what's wrong with all these other folks because, you know, we don't know that they got those electrodes in their brains and they're under the spell of the Matrix. They're loving it.
They are under a spell. They love the con. They've bought into it. And it doesn't matter if we historically and accurately know exactly where this leads. They just giggle at us. It's funny. Let's talk to Robert in Texas. Thanks for holding, Robert. You're on the air.
Great show, as usual, Alex, and a excellent analysis from Joseph. Always a good guest there. I just wanted to quickly mention Big Pharma as one of the fronts that the people really need to pay attention to. And I feel like natural alternatives are a way to go. I just interviewed Rick Simpson, the man who cured cancer in Canada using pure cannabis extract. That interview is on Funkmaster 5 channel if y'all want to look at that. A lot of people out there listening probably know somebody who's affected by a chronic illness and are taking poison to treat it.
You know what? You know what? What's that guy's name? Because I've seen his research, and it's I've seen a lot of other studies that show cannabis oil has amazing effects, and the FDA's been trying to block it. What's his name again?
His name is Rick Simpson. He's from Nova Scotia, Canada. We just interviewed him last week.
No, I understand. Well, listen, what I'm going to do is I'm going to get some scientists on about hemp oil, but that's a separate issue I wanted to raise to Joseph Farah here. He was talking about election fraud. Does anybody really buy? Does anybody out there really in their wildest dreams and imagination really believe that Prop 37 got voted down like that in California to know if something's organic? And then what do you think about Obama going after the marijuana? Joseph Farah.
Well, all I know is that we are the most heavily medicated society in the history of the world. All you got to do is watch television, and every other commercial is drug peddling. And, you know, it's crazy because, you know, I mean, I used to be kind of a hardliner on drug legalization. Now, I mean, I realize that what the federal government is doing with this so-called war on drugs, not a war at all, what it really is, it's a way to control people. And you know, we could see how effective the war on drugs was with the Fast and Furious, for instance, where we're actually giving guns to the drug cartel. But yeah, Big Pharma is one of the biggest problems we have, because I think what it essentially comes down to is they're keeping people. That's the Matrix, okay? Well, they're not plugged into electrodes, but they're doped up and dumped down.
That's right. Stay there. We'll be right back. We're back live, ladies and gentlemen. It is our final segment here with Joseph Farah of WorldNet Daily. Your calls and a ton of news and special reports are coming up after the break. Right now, let's go back to your calls. John in Minnesota, quick question or comment for Joseph Farah.
Yes, I was calling in to tell a little story and also how the FEMA camps, how they plan to fill them. I was a FEMA inspector. Still listed as one. And after what I saw last year and what I was threatened with, I decided not to go out for them anymore. I called this in back in March or April. I called in to Sean Hannity's show, and they vetted me for 2 hours, checked me out, said that they were going to make a whole show around it and possibly bring me in to be on the TV show as well. The following week, they never called me back, and I called back into the show and talked to the producer. I had her private line, and she said that Sean had decided not to follow this story, that It just wasn't something that they were going
to
do.
All right, well, I'm probably going to have to put you on hold because Joseph Farah's got to leave here in about 4 minutes. But give us a brief encapsulation, then we'll come back to you after the break.
Okay. I got stationed in Philadelphia and was inspecting homes that were basically crack houses with decades of dilapidation. And I found children living in the squalor and, you know, with drug deals and drug use going on right in front of them, and called it in, and then they told me to mind my own business.
If you got a healthy baby, if the bow doesn't match their dress, the CPS will take them because they've got folks that want the kid. If the child is being eaten by rats, literally, they won't help them if it's a good drug dealing operation to launder some money for the banks. Joseph Farah, any comments on what this caller's talking about?
Well, I think he picked the wrong show to take his story to. I think he should have taken it to the Alex Jones show. You guys ought to exchange numbers. I want to hear more.
No, exactly. I'm going to put you on hold, sir. You can send us your stuff. We'll vet it, and then we'll get you on. But I'll come back and have you tell your story just because it matches from what I know. I mean, you'll hear about the foster parents with this with kids, and they can't get in trouble. Let's jam in. Well, you know, we're out of time for calls until I come back in the next break. Joseph Farah, any closing comments you'd like to make today?
Well, just, look, we're in for trying times. We talked about this during the break, Alex. You know, things are going to get worse before they get better. It's a time for, you know, redoubling our efforts, preparedness. We got to think survival for the next few years. And it's very important that people, like-minded people, even if, you know, maybe previously we thought we were in competition with one another, we got to stick together. Because if we don't, we're going to, you know, hang separately. And so, you know, everybody out there listens to Alex Jones. I would urge you to support his work in whatever way you can, whether that means buying his great books and DVDs, this is no time for nitpicking between, you know, constitutionalists, people who are liberty minded. We're going to have to stick together. We're up against it big time, and so stay the course. I know I predicted doomsday in the next 4 years, but there's a very good chance that the coming tyranny we're going to see, the increasing tyranny we see in these next few years, might just be the wake-up call that America needs to reverse course.
Well, it will be if we use it like judo and use their energy against us, but everybody better redouble their efforts and not just go to sleep and complain. Now is the time to take over the states. Joseph Farah, thank you so much for the time.
All right, Alan. Good luck.
We'll be right back. Stay with us. Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central. That's 12 noon to 3 p.m. Eastern. We're here live waging war on corruption, crashing through the lies and disinformation. I am your host, Alex Jones, and it is the day before Thanksgiving. You know, I want to talk about how important this anti-TSA, pro-Fourth Amendment, pro-civil rights movement is that has gotten so big and that so many great people have gotten involved with. I also want to get into the incredible economic news and a bunch of military news. I've got to get to all this, and I've got to focus and get it done in the hour we have left here. Now 50 minutes we have left total. Let's go back to your calls. We just in the last segment took a call from John in Minnesota, who was talking about FEMA going in, and I know they're checking floodplains and also architecture in cities. In certain areas, he's saying he would just see people living in crack houses, children living like animals. I've probably seen the story he's talking about. You learn how to gauge how a caller sounds, and then plus the info they give you, you pretty much automatically know if they're for real or not. But I don't ever go off my gut, even though my gut's never wrong. It's like, the gut says the guy's telling the truth, plus you've got info to back it up. Now send me your information. We'll have you on. But, you know, so many times we have whistleblowers on and later they go, hey, can you take that down? They're coming after me. And so I just also want to tell people something. The eye of Sauron is on this show. The eye of the New World Order is fully aware of what we're doing. And I say, good, put me on your list, come after me. Because I know how evil you are. And letting this type of evil come in is what is hurting the little children. The CPS was set up 100 years ago, roughly, we were going to the caller, as race eugenics courts or race hygiene courts. You may have heard of that, but only from the Nazis. That's because the media will talk about that. The Nazis got it from the United States and England. England developed it. The U.S. perfected it. The Germans blew its bad, its good name. I had a Freudian slip. It's bad name, but they gave it its bad name because it deserves one. I was about to say it's blew its bad name, but I couldn't say that. I said good. Point is, they were pushing it as a great thing until Hitler gave it a bad name because it deserved one. And I've seen this with the foster parents, not all of them. There's some good Christian families out there, but predominantly the warehousers of kids. I have seen it with the warehousing homes. They're all state certified, folks, and you can kill kids in these things and they don't lose their licenses. I've seen cases where you've got to have three kids die in a small home in a year. It was one in Oklahoma, a case, and they had the CPS director go, "Children will die. That's just the way it is." That was the headline on the article. Children will die. Because in 1 week, two had died, then one had died the month before. They were letting like two-year-olds swim alone at the CPS home and had a pool in the back. It was a taken over old hotel. The point is, where do you think the pedophiles go? Where do you think the abusers go? Where do you think they go to be in the government envelope where they're the authority, so they're above reproach and they wouldn't do anything wrong? Folks, that's in history the most dangerous thing is the government. So the caller, I don't know what his story is yet. I only heard about a minute of it because we had to go to break. He brought up how he went to the media, tried to get this out. They wouldn't cover it. And how he was a FEMA inspector and the nightmare stuff he saw in the inner cities. And yes, if it is, because that's what you can get $500,000 for through the adoption agencies. If it's a black-haired, blue-eyed, or green-eyed person, they'll kill parents for them. That's, for whatever reason, I've talked to the top people involved exposing this. One of them was a state senator they murdered when she had just called me a week before and said, "I've got total proof of the list, the roundups, how they're picking kids out. I'm coming on your show next week." Well, they killed her a couple days later, blew her and her husband's head off. But side issue, she had the quotas, the list, all of it. I don't know where his story's going. He just said he was in FEMA. He'd go in and see these crack houses and they wouldn't do anything. Look, if it's a blonde-haired, blue-eyed baby, and you go to have your child for the first time at the hospital, they'll make it up and say there's marijuana in your blood and take your kid. And if you try to fight back, the cops will gun you down, okay? That's the way it works in America. They do what they're told. If you're a black baby or a Hispanic baby, they can drag those kids along behind their car, and no one's going to get in trouble. I mean, if it's Hispanic or blacks, they may throw them in jail for it. But if it's black kids in foster care, you might as well put them in a wood chipper. Before the media spins that, I'm not saying put them in a wood chipper. I'm illustrating how horribly they're treated. The media loves to take stuff out of context of what I say, but people know they do that, so it's fine. But anyway, sir, I'm going to give you the floor for about 4 or 5 minutes. We're going to go to break, take a few more calls for those that have been holding. Then I've got a news blitz and play these special reports. You've got the floor. Tell us why you were inspecting, what you did at FEMA, why you left, and then we'll vet your information and do a full report for you. And we're going to give you, I'm going to give your number to Rob Due to call you. Go ahead.
All right. I was a disaster inspector. So just a warning for all the listeners, especially those in the Northeast right now, do not take the FEMA money. There's a clause that you sign on the tablet at the beginning. The print is so fine that it's illegible. But I read it, and basically it says that you owe this money back, and the federal government can seize your house and property if it's not paid back, if you're able to pay it back. Most people aren't, so they'll end up seizing the property. When that time period is, I cannot say.
And I'll back you up. That's why they're now saying they're not going to let most of New Jersey and New York, the mom-and-pop motels and hotels, aren't going to be allowed to rebuild for environmental reasons, but the government will authorize big companies to come in. So this is how they take over. Go ahead.
Okay, so I was stationed in New Jersey, and FEMA had run out of money earlier in the year because of the tornadoes in Alabama and Joplin, and then some of the flooding up in North Dakota. So they went to Congress and asked for more money. When Congress gave FEMA the amount of money, I'm not sure what it was. It might have been like $7 billion. This is when, Irene and Lee hit up in the Northeast last year, towards the end of the year, just like Sandy did this year. Irene and Lee didn't cause as much damage. It was a lot of flooding, a lot of rain. Now, the people I was helping out in New Jersey last year were legitimately, they couldn't do anything, and insurance wasn't going to pay because it was flood. And it was also man-made because they released a dam that flooded these towns.
I understand. I remember that. So tell people what you found and what the scandal is.
Okay, so they sent that when FEMA gave them that, or they got the money from Congress, Congress also passed a law granting power to the executive branch, the president, that he could claim any area, a natural disaster area, without the governor of that state asking for federal assistance.
I saw that in the news as well, yes.
The very next day, I was out of New Jersey and in Philadelphia giving crack houses, crackheads, tens of thousands of dollars for decades of dilapidation. Tens of thousands, okay? They got 1 inch of rain in Philadelphia from those two storms. 1 inch. We were replacing roofs, remodeling houses, but we were just giving them money. Those money was probably being smoked up in crack pipe. That's 75% of the houses that I went into were crack houses.
Unbelievable. So what type of stuff were you seeing when you went in these houses?
Filth, knee-deep, spent condoms. I'm sorry, but this is, crack pipes laying around, hypodermic needles, whiskey, and beer bottles. So the first one that I went to, I actually had a gun pulled on me outside, and the guy told him to get away that I was there for him, and he said he was a block captain, and they were going to listen to him. So I went in. It was the three-story row house. Went in. It looked like somebody had hit a hornet's nest. That's how many flies were in this place. I get up to the third level and realize that there's kids living in this field. Three floors of crack smoking and crack dealing going on right in front of me. I called it in for the kids, and they told me to mind my own business.
All right, listen, I'm going to put you on hold. I got to give you more time. Stay there, yeah. I've seen this literally myself on investigations. But when your kid at school falls and breaks their arm, they'll still try to take them because you're healthy. There's some fat pedophile wants to get your kid. And they shop. You know, there's pedophiles want a five-year-old, they're going to get one. They want a newborn, they're going to get one. Or they just got well-meaning families that get them. The CPS is there to prey on good families and protect. I'm going to do it. I can take you to a crack house right now.
He decides.
Okay, John in Minnesota, finishing up your story. I'm going to have Rob do. John Harmon up there is going to IM him your number, and we're going to get in touch with you. You can send us your documentation, and then we will get you on air via video, Skype, or something next week if you want to use your identity or not. So, but everything you're saying I already know to be true. So basically, you're told just give a bunch of money to the crack house areas. And again, I started out on Access Television 17 years ago, and it was right in an area of East Austin that had the guys coming out selling the crack. I was at a gas station last week, and there was a guy parked in a car with cars pulling up, selling him some kind of white powder in little baggies. And I knew not to call the cops. Nothing was going to happen. If they did, I'd probably get arrested for it or something. Besides, the government ships most of it in to begin with, unless it's methamphetamine that they're cooking up. You know, private groups cook that up. That's why the government really hates that so much. They don't get as big a cut because it's more grassroots. Certainly bad for you as well. But I also, growing up in Dallas, Texas, they wouldn't sell us beer in Rockwall where I lived, underage people. And I routinely, almost every weekend, I'd ride in with older kids. You know, because I was cool when I was 12, 13, 14, 15. I got to hang out with the folks that are a few years older than me. Can't believe how much danger I was in. We would drive to South Dallas in the crack neighborhoods. and right next to the liquor stores, right next to the liquor stores, there would be crack houses right there. And to be honest, a couple times, they would not sell us alcohol. And when I was like 14, I was dumb enough. They said, hey, Alex, you and Chris or whatever, you go over there and they'll sell it to you there. And sure enough, they did. But let me tell you, once or twice walking in one of those, I knew, and I wasn't there again to get drugs. I was there to get, 12-pack of beer. Because the crack houses sell alcohol as well, for those that don't know. It's a one-stop shop. But, I mean, you walk into these things, and there's a guy with a gun on the table, marijuana, cocaine, whatever. You want alcohol, you little such and such, you little racial slur? Bam, give me the money. Boom, you're out. And a cop drives right by when you come out. So I guess there I am telling you that story. But right down here, right off East 11th, I want to do that because I still drive down there sometimes. They're still there. I want to go. I'll do it. I won't tell the crew to do it. I want to go, and I want to go walk into crack houses. And then I'll call the police from the crack house. I mean, they know where they are. It's a joke. I'm sorry. They allow these districts to operate to sell everybody the drugs. Okay? I mean, that's how this works. The prostitutes, all of it. Going back to the caller, quickly finishing your story. So you said something about this. What happened?
They kept telling me to mind my own business. And I, they said that just send me home. Well, we don't have much money, so I had to stay out in the field. 3 days later, my first appointment was at a house, and they didn't answer the door. Left a note. She called up later in the afternoon just screaming at me that I had never showed up. Well, I could tell by the slur in her voice that she was already high, and she was probably sleeping off her ride the evening before. So I get there. I showed up late in the afternoon. It was actually getting close to dark. We weren't supposed to be out at that time anyway. She was listed by herself as the owner and registered of getting the FEMA money and the owner of the house. And there were four children listed. Everybody listed, all the children are in the computer system. They show up. So I go in the house, and dog feces, ceilings caving in, walls cracked and caving in, just horrible conditions. And the four kids that are listed on a computer are running around the house. Well, there was another girl there, older, one of her friends, was staring me down like I was a cop and left right then. We were going through the inspection, and I could hear a baby crying upstairs, and she kept screaming, "Shut up, baby, shut up." And I mean screaming, I don't want to scream like she did. And I could just hear the baby crying upstairs. But it wasn't listed on the computer, so I figured it was the other girl's baby. So we finally go upstairs, and I can hear the baby's up in the front room, and she's continuing to scream, "Shut up, baby," not checking on it or anything. And there were four rooms upstairs. That was the last one I was inspecting because that's the flow of the way it was going. We open up the door, and there's the baby laying on the floor.
Tell what, stay there. We got to finish this after the break. Yeah, unbelievable. Unbelievable. We're going to hear what happened. And then, tries to get help. Ain't coming. But you yell at your two-year-old daughter in front of people at the Yuppie Club, a fat pedophile is going to have your child that night. We'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen, breaking down this information. Stay with us.
We're on the march.
By the way, we've had our reporters out at the airports. We've also had our reporters out at airports that they've been traveling through to visit family, part of our opt-out and film the TSA. And I filmed the TSA before and had them tell me not to film. But I will go over to the Austin-Bergstrom Airport sometime this week, maybe next Monday, just so they can run up and freak out and say you can't film and go, number one, it's the law, I can. Here's your own website. I know that. Stop acting like I've done something wrong. Stop acting like all the theater, they're terrorists everywhere. Your boss has put the underwear bomber on the plane on record. You guys are now arresting people because they have digital watches saying they can make a bomb. You're the takeover arm. Hey, you like that cancer you're getting from the scanners? You like that? I'm going to hand out flyers about the cancer risk. and just let them freak out. And it's all a much ado about nothing. The government's shipping in the drugs. The government's laundering the drug money. The government's running child kidnapping rings. The government's, you know, giving trillions to foreign banks. The government's involved in every crime you can imagine. But they want to, all over the country, they're trying to train cops that filming is illegal. And they arrest people and it gets thrown out of court. And cops lose lawsuits. In Illinois, they try to put a guy in prison for life for filming the cops. And when the court threw it out, I had the guy on, the state attorney came down and tried to lobby to get it reinstated. I mean, they want you life in prison for filming police in public. Not doing anything wrong. You shouldn't be afraid of it. That's the thing they tell us. You see, they don't like these equalizers. Now, good cops out there, and there are a lot of them, they understand that big government's dangerous. They understand no checks and balances are dangerous. And they understand it's good that people are out there filming. You know, if I was a cop and a good cop, I would hope people were filming. Because, you know, then there's a record of what went on. Don't have something to hide? You know, there it is. My whole issue is they get into our private information, which they shouldn't do. It violates the law. With the NSA and the rest of it. But then our public stuff, they want to say, is off limits. No, no, no. It's the privacy of your home. And why don't I want cameras in my house? Nothing to hide except my privacy. I want to be able to do what I want. I want to be, you know. All creatures need their privacy. But out in public, you don't have any. And the fact that they want to try to threaten to arrest people, the rest of it, that's coming up. Man, I've got so much to get to here. Okay, so you're a FEMA inspector. You're going to these houses, crack houses. You go up to the next floor of this house. You're inspecting. This baby's been screaming. You open the door. What do you see with the baby you've been hearing screaming?
I'm sorry, Alex. I kind of broke down after just thinking about this story.
Go ahead. It's okay.
I walked in.
Go ahead. It's okay. Be strong for the baby. Tell us what happened.
The baby was laying in a pile of trash, no diaper, no nothing, just laying there with an empty bottle, dried snot and tears covered its face. And the flies and fleas were on top of it. And she stood over the baby and started stomping beside its head, screaming to shut up, MF-er, shut up. At the top of her lungs, to the point of where I couldn't even, my eardrums were already, this continued while I inspected the room for damages that were decades of dilapidation, you know, and she's doing this right in front of me.
I understand. So, just like the TSA gropes us in front of us, it's all about out in the open. So how did this end?
I stepped out of the room, and right when I got there, the girl that had left had showed back up, and they closed the door behind me, but it was still cracked. And I can hear the girl that I inspected the house for, and she said, "Did you get it? Did you get it? Did you get it? Give me a hit." They started smoking rock right above that baby. And I said, I just said, "I need your signature, so I can leave." So she came out, signed it, and she actually exhaled the crack smoke in my face.
Oh, yeah. Listen, I could take into a live feed to anywhere in East Austin and show people smoking crack on the side of the street and cops driving by. And I could take you to any city in the U.S. and show this. But then if I get pulled over, the cops are going to ask if I got drugs. And I'm like, do I look like I'm using the government's garbage? And cops that have pulled me over know that this happens. And they say, "Oh, what's your problem?" What's my problem? The government ships it in. Don't give me your holier-than-thou garbage anymore. And it just makes me upset about the entire situation. And yes, I know about that. And I have absolutely not witnessed things like that, but I've read about it in the news where it's a baby eaten by rats, eaten by flies in a, you know, or you'll see the stories of a 7-year-old that weighed 17, you know, pounds and, you know, was like shriveled up and couldn't talk, you know, and death was a mercy. And this is going on everywhere and the CPS doesn't want them because they're already being killed. That's what they want. They want your healthy kid. If you're a good black Christian family, with your kids all healthy and clean cut. You won't give your kids inoculations. They take them. We've covered those cases in Michigan. If you're a white homeschooling family, they're coming after you. They are a force of evil. I have been around them. Finish your story. Let me guess. You tried to call FEMA, tried to call others. What happened? I personally would have called 911. And see, that's why I'm going to be honest. The one area I'm cowardly in is this area, because when I saw a cop choking a woman to make her sign a document to hand her kid over, because it was a blonde-haired, blue-eyed baby, and they even filed fake paperwork, I walked in the room and knew if I attacked the guy, I'd go to jail and wouldn't be able to keep fighting him, so I had to leave. But then that gave me nightmares, because at a primitive level, I should have physically defended the woman. I mean, it was all in a split second what I was going to do to the guy, but I didn't do it. I was ready to execute on him, but you know, execute the defense of the woman. But I stood down, and doing that is very unhealthy for you. And so that's why I don't want to go show the crack houses. I don't want to go look at them. I know why people leave it all over there rotting, because it's hard to look at, but it's going on by design. So finishing your story, and then we'll get a hold of you and vet your story and then get it out for everybody. Finish the story.
All right, so I go outside, and, you know, I have like a 10-minute cry there because I couldn't control myself in my vehicle. And I call up my FEMA office, and I tell them what's going on. There's a baby that's not even registered in the computer. That it doesn't exist. She probably had the baby in the house, and nobody even knows that it's in there except for me. So I call them up, and they said, no, you're not. We've told you before, this is not what you're there for. It's none of your business. And I said, well, I'm going to make it my business. If y'all aren't going to do anything, I'm going to call the police. I'm going to call CPS. And before I could even finish my sentence, she blurted out, if you call anybody, we will have you arrested for violating her civil rights. This is what I was told.
Yeah, and plus, just so everybody knows, that's a fraud. No matter what you're told, if a commission of a crime is happening and they tell you, oh, well, there's a privacy clause, all that goes out the window, you know, even with doctor-client privilege. That's how doctors spy on you now for no reason, is because, well, they thought a commission of a crime was happening. They twist that. If you sign forms of confidentiality and you're working somewhere and they're making methamphetamine in the bathtub, you're allowed to go expose that. Go ahead.
So, you know, being as scared as I was and wanting to keep making money.
I understand. You drove out of there, but you tried, and she tried to do the right thing later to get the story out. So how did this end?
Well, 3 days later, I went in and to another inspection, and the lady, when I walked up, she said, I bet you've seen some SH around here, hadn't you? And I said, oh, yeah. And she was an old black hippie lady. And the things that were coming out of her mouth were totally unexpected. And I did her inspection, and during the inspection, I told her about that, what had happened. And we were sitting down at her dining room table, filling out the last bit of paperwork, and she slid a tablet across the table and said, you're going to write down that name and address, you know, because she had wanted it before. And I said, you know, I can't do that. I just can't do that. And she got very angry with me, and she said, you don't think that God put you in that baby's life and then put you in mine so that we could save that baby? This is what I do, is I save those children. You're going to write that down, and you're not leaving here alive. She made me see the light, and I went into my computer, and I gave her every single address that I had been to that was a crack house that had children in it. You know, I did a third party. And I've been scared ever since for the past year that something's going to happen to me. And now that I'm on the air finally talking about it, I'm really scared.
Well, listen, don't be scared, brother, because every time I think about the New World Order killing me or even coming after my kids, none of them have a future if we don't stand up now. That's the thing about this evil. And everybody has got to go and expose these crack houses. Everybody has got to go and expose all this stuff. Drugs aren't fun. They're not cool. None of this is. And you did the right thing. The fact that you drove off crying, I've done the same thing watching the CPS do stuff. Because, you know, in your mind, you know, you're thinking about how you've got to defend this person. You know it's wrong. But, you know, then there's the shell shock. What matters is you end up doing the right thing in the end. You know, it's never too late. And the fact that you even cared, a lot of people would just, doing my job, you people are disgusting, whatever, you know, blah, 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 and then leave and dehumanize those people. The fact that you cared about it. Rob Dew's got your number. We're going to end up getting in touch with you Friday as we're off tomorrow. I got a great rebroadcast lined up. And that's basically that. But God bless you, sir, and I appreciate your information, okay?
Yeah, I really want to say that those people that have FEMA knocking on the door, please do not fill that out. They'll be able to seize your property if you don't pay that back. You could end up getting $30,000, and a year down the road, they're going to want it back.
And again, that's the rest of the story. That's why they've got Google actuaries. They know where all the crack houses are in databases, and I'd actually read about this. They're sending money to them so they can take the property later. It's all very, very cold-blooded. Well, listen, thank you so much, and I'm glad you have the strength to tell that story, John. We're going to be talking to you very soon. There goes John. I don't want that falling through the cracks, guys. Yeah, and that's exactly how it works. Then he's telling this other woman this story, and then she says, hey, God put you in that house for a reason, put you in this house for a reason. You're going to give me that information. Everybody's got to stop being so cowardly. You know what I mean? I mean, if something's evil, you've got to oppose it. It doesn't mean you've got to oppose everything all the time. But when your heart tells you you got to oppose something, get past being cowardly. I mean, I think about what CPS does to kids. You know the most dangerous place for children? Even when you average in all the bad drug addict parents and the abusers and the alcoholics and everything, do you know in the government's own numbers, they don't publicize them a lot, but you can pull them up, on the average year, you are 5 to 7 times more likely to be sexually or physically abused in whose custody? Child Protective Services. And they just zombify the kids and put them on antipsychotics. I'm talking two-year-olds. You cry for mommy, that's mental illness. And that's why anytime I have physical fear for myself, instantly, God just says, you know what you've seen with the children. And I can just see it all. And there's not, and it's not that I'm even embarrassed that my flesh is weak and that I would even have an inkling of fear, the inkling of fear. I have fear that I'm so weak. I have fear that I don't execute resistance against these people properly with all the gifts I've been given. Because let me tell you, the evil is going on 24/7. People go, oh, there's always evil. It's increasing because there's an attitude now that, oh, that's just the way it is. You can't do anything. The CPS grabbing our kids outside of real courts, the TSA power grabbing, and people now resisting that. Think about it. We're able to now have people all over the country videotaping, and the TSA is trying to force people through scanners and ripping the clothes off little girls that turn out to be state representatives in Texas, and they're beating people up, and they're threatening people. Got big stacks of news on it today up at Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. But it doesn't matter because more and more people are angry and upset, and they don't care. They're going to resist. I've seen two different national polls, 156, 152, are saying people are opting out of the scanners. It's happening everywhere. And it's the same thing. Little things grow. Big things have small beginnings. And we're not meant to be slaves. And there's always a struggle between good and evil. And I'm not offering anybody a utopia. Anybody that says they've got a utopia is a fraud. What I'm saying is that we need to pull away from evil and just swim as hard as we can away from it. Evil has a gravitational pull, and you want to get away from it. And it's always that eternal struggle of trying to get away from it. In our own lives, you know, changing things is an inside job. And, you know, shame on all these churches that go out and selectively find some poor people they claim they're going to take care of. Or, you know, shame on all the yuppies that walk up to me in grocery stores and say, what's wrong? Or say to my son, like I'm not even there, what's wrong with your eye? My son has a birthmark on the side of his head. And he says, it's my birthmark. You know, and I guaranteed he's smarter than they are at 10 years old. And then I'll go, hey, you can talk to me. I'm here. Oh, this is the thing. You don't have any kids, do you? What are you, a social worker? Yeah, you are. And then you want to come in here and like a pervert talk to my kid. I'm not a pervert. How dare you? No, but it's like a pervert superseding. You don't have the courage or the will to have a kid. You don't have the courage to raise them up. You just got the courage to come in here and get in front of them like, you don't like it now that I'm in your face. Why don't you go worry about the crack houses down the street? Why don't you go worry about the CPS abusing kids? Oh, but it's about the religion that you see. The liberals have their counterfeit of being good people and being involved in the community. They have their counterfeit where they run around all day how they're good and we're all terrorists and the TSA has to check us all and our pies and cakes can't fly with those and we're going to have to pull your shirt up in public. I mean, I've sat there while a male TSA worker gets down there to grope me because I've got to fly out somewhere. And they're saying, either this or you don't fly. So I go, okay, I'll do a test. And the guy gets down on his knees and is licking his lips. I mean, he's, you know. And it's so alien to me, the idea of getting off on putting people in bad situations and making them do something. But see, there's a lot of people like to make people do things, ladies and gentlemen. That's what this is all about. And that for them is the thrill. Seeing that beautiful woman in the line that they could never get with the electric eyes and the beauty, you know what I'm talking about. And I'll be there with the guys. I go, watch this. They're going to pull her out for groping. She's doing the scanner. Look, the sharks are coming in. And boy, they get that woman. And it is. I mean, oh my gosh. It's groping time. You know, I said I would air these special reports and get to this economic news. So I'm going into the fourth hour live. I know it's on XM, and a lot of the stations carry it because I used to do 4 hours every day. By the way, I only bring my son to work with me about once a week. He is homeschooled, and he's here training and video editing and reporting. He came running up going, oh, yeah, I can tell the story. So we have a part-time nanny. He says it's really bad when they go to the grocery store. And I was asking him, I said, how does mom respond? You know, sometimes I say, hey, I'm here. I'm his dad. You know, ask me why that happened. Oh, you're a bad male. And I said, let me guess, is it chicken-necked, weirdo, liberal women? And he goes, yes, it's usually old ladies. And here is my son here on air with us. And he wanted to say something about this. Again, this is unscripted, so I don't know exactly what he's going to say. But he has a small, handsome birthmark on his left eyelid, and then one on the side of his head when he was a baby. It was more pronounced, but now he's got hair over it, and it's evil. And I, at a park anywhere, and it's always a weird chicken neck liberal comes over and says, "What's wrong with your eye? Did someone do something to you?" And it's always so insulting because, and you're like, no, it's my birthmark. Really? Did someone tell you to say that? Again, they're hunting for kids to get. They're hunting because they've been told what to alert on. Now, if it's a crack house kid, no help's coming. But son, go ahead and tell folks the story.
Well, Dad, it's normally an old lady and she says, "What's wrong with your eye, boy?" And then I say, "It's my birthmark." And she has...
They don't really talk like that, do they?
I'm just trying to imitate.
Okay. Are you okay. Serious? Okay.
Yes, I'm serious. They come over and ask, "What's wrong with your eye?" And then I say, "It's my birthmark." And they say exactly what you said. They said, "Is that what someone told you to say? Is that true? Or is that true?" It's really, really embarrassing sometimes because my sisters are around.
Well, yeah, and they really get upset when it's a really good-looking family. It upsets them to no end. I mean, we've had them come up in Whole Foods repeatedly and say it's bad to have three kids. And so any way to knock that out, any way to get, I'm telling you, these are evil people. We're not joking around here. You must see, good people are blind to this. We don't understand what we're facing. How many times a week or how many times a month, son, does this happen to you? I mean, I know when I'm out with you, it happens quite often when we're in liberal controlled areas in their occupied zones of destruction. But how often does this happen?
Usually, if I'm out a lot on that month to like grocery stores, Walgreens, that sort of thing, it is about 3 or 4 times a month.
And then they continue, like they do in front of me. It's like, here, I'm the dad. I'm sitting there at a checkout line. What happened to your eye? It's my birthmark. Did someone tell you to say that? And they look up at you. And you're sitting there clean cut, nice, great looking kids. And you're like, it's insulting. He's got a birthmark, lady. Leave him alone. You know, I mean, again, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, there's that guy. One time there was this guy who says, "What's wrong with your eye? Did someone punch you? Was it your parents?" And I said, "No, it's my birthmark." And he says, "Oh, really?"
Yeah, it's probably a pedophile, piece of trash, enemy of America, enemy of humanity, the dark ones, the evil ones, the destroyers, the satanic ones. I'm sorry, son, I can't stand them. Anyways, when did this happen?
Well, when it was with Monica, you know, my old nanny.
Yeah.
It was like a year ago.
And where was this?
I think at H-E-B.
Oh, man, I tell you. You got to watch out, folks. You got to watch out. All right, thank you.
He's absolutely right. Protect your children.
All right, thank you, son. We're going to be debuting him with his name and everything very, very soon. He wants to go on air. And, his wish is my command. If it's just, it will be. All right, we're not going to retransmission. I'm coming up. Look, we'll do this. We'll run through your calls quickly. You've been holding patiently. And then I'll get to these special reports. All of this straight ahead.
On the GCN Radio Network.
Well, if you just joined us, we had a caller who we're vetting, but I've seen it myself as part of the course. Breaking down where he'd go in these crack houses for FEMA disaster funds, and there'd be kids literally in a state of, you know, near death from what I heard. And FEMA, CPS, none of them would do anything because they don't want poor kids. They want to make sure they die as quickly as possible. That's all covered up. And then I was just getting into how the yuppies just flip out when you've got three kids. Boy, they're really not going to like me coming down the road here soon. And they get in your face about all this stuff. And that's why I carry my iPhone at all times now. I'm going to start just videotaping them. You think I'm joking about this? I've told my wife, next time one of these women walks over and goes, "Do you really think you really have three kids? You think that's a good idea? Think that's good for the earth?" I mean, these people are cult members is all I'm telling you. So they're trying to take my kids because one of them's got a birthmark. And knock on wood, my children have never had any serious injuries or been to the hospital. And then meanwhile, kids in the most dangerous things with horrible parents, they leave them with them. And it just makes me sick. Again, liberals are the counterfeit of everything they claim they are. That's my point. Thomas Jefferson, a liberal. You, an authoritarian punk. Let's go to your calls here. Just run through them quickly. John's been holding too long, and so has Michael and Simon. And then we'll get to folks in Israel, David in Israel. John in Florida, thanks for holding. Go ahead.
How you doing? I'm a long-time listener and a first-time caller. I just wanted to know about a couple of things that I know you're always on top of. First is sequestration. I'm really scared about it. I don't know much. Maybe you can let me know about that.
Well, I mean, that's just where they have automatic spending cuts in the military. Go ahead.
I was thinking that it was more than that. I was hearing reports and reading online about how when sequestration is supposed to start cutting down on welfare and all these other things. So, and also the secession. How is government supposed to help people that are already, you know, bound by the government and the states pull out? How does this transition occur?
Well, here's the deal. It's slowly going to collapse anyways. If it continues down the road, the way you help people is producing an economy and a society. Instead, they destroy the society and then make you basically go on welfare. That's the plan. And so it's absolutely devilish, and that's how you get locked between a rock and a hard place.
Also, one more thing I needed to tell you. It had to do with voting for Obama. My daughter, she's a six-year-old. She's in first grade. And they have these little things where they try to teach them, they teach them how to vote. But my daughter doesn't know anything about voting. She comes home one day and she tells me, "Daddy, I voted." I'm speechless. She tells me she voted for Obama because that's what the schools told her. Pick between these two pictures, whose name sounds better? And you like Obama? And I asked the teacher, I asked the assistant principal, and they told me, Well, we're just letting them, you know, choose between what's their choice. And, you know, it was like I was talking to a little kid. Incredible.
Well, you're right. That's the thing. It's an arrested development in the general population, which robs people of their true destinies and is the ultimate sin. And it's what we struggle against, John. But it's a terrible situation that they would spend $22 billion to move General Motors to China, or part of its plants for Volt and Cadillac, and then say that the voters in the Rust Belt states voted for Obama because he would give them benefits. Like, but their kids won't ever have any jobs. Listen, we're going to go to break. We're going to come back with more calls. We ought to do a show where I take calls from Israel and the Palestinian areas, because that'd be good to hear both sides on that sometimes. Maybe we'll do that on Friday. Well, I'm not here Friday. It's Mike Adams. We'll be right back. It is Wednesday, the 21st day of November, 2012. I'm Alex Jones, your host, and we have Joseph Farah of WorldNetDaily joining us in the second hour to talk about the agenda of Barack Obama. You know, I read the articles they wrote. It confirmed my own analysis. And I got to tell you, everything that Joseph Farah and others said that Obama was planning in his next 4 years is certainly, unfortunately, being proven true. In fact, and then some. Never underestimate the activities of a group of control freaks who've been given basically unlimited governmental power to dominate the population. Never underestimate what they'll do. Never underestimate hiring a bunch of minimum wage employees, giving them a 2-week training course and telling them that they can read minds and that everyone is a potential terrorist. Of course, they'll go from 9,000 employees.
Since I was 16. And, I was really glad to see you talk about Israel this morning, because I've been an avid fan, and I've seen a lot of crazy alternative documentaries on YouTube that try to accuse you of being some type of Israeli agent that are just ridiculous. And anyway, I was glad to see that you touched on that subject today.
Well, here's the deal. You've got to accuse me of being a bunch of other agents, too. That's probably a cognitive dissonance, Cass Sunstein-style operation, because they really go crazy when I do criticize Israel. And it has the reverse psychology of making me never want to criticize Israel, because that is a popular internet meme where some nobody who never stood up for anybody, never did anything, never said their real name, never had skin in the game, can just say, Alex Jones is a Vatican agent, or Alex Jones is a Israel agent, or Alex Jones is this or that. And sometimes they go find distant members of my family and then mix it in with other people who aren't my family and say, you know, horrible things. Like, they'll show a picture of some dentist named David Jones at the George Herbert Walker Bush Memorial in Houston and say, that's his dad. It's the proof. You know, when it's not even the right middle name, and there's photos of my dad online. And then people are like, we ought to get his dad. And that's when it kind of gets to you. It's like, man, they're not just lying about me. You know, they're lying about my dad. And again, I come from a family where even if you don't like somebody, you tend to not talk bad about them. I'm kind of the anomaly that I've gotten to the point where I'm just done playing games. So I'm firing in all directions at people that have done us wrong. But, you know, I certainly, if I'm going to go after somebody on air, then I'm going to try to have my ducks in a row and be right about it. I'm not going to try to accuse somebody, you know, who's innocent of something. But that's a way, it's been successful, of beating people into submission. I remember 10 years ago, if you said Jews were the seed of the devil, but you thought Hitler was bad, that was okay. You know, first it was weird. It's not that Jews are the devil, Zionists are the devil. And then it's like, no, Jews are inherently the devil. And people will edit that out and say, I said that. I'm not. People know. People are wise to the tricks. Just be aware of it, folks. This is more and more that's happened where they take like 3 words out and, you know, put it out there. And you're not trustworthy enough if you don't think all Jews should be killed. And you, so it just radicalizes, where it's just cartoon land, where people don't even know how to write, but they can say this person's this or that. When they don't know Israel, we've got a call from Israel, we'll go to here in a few minutes, is very diverse politically. There's a lot of stuff going on. You know, if you look at what Israel's doing and what was done to the Native Americans here, there's parallels, except Israel could argue their people were there before, so they have the stake. Groups ethnically push each other out. And I think it's ugly, it's horrible, it's primitive, it's wrong. Both sides are wrong. That's why the globalists are financing both sides. I've covered that ad nauseum. You know, I've covered the USS Liberty. I've made films on it. And the white supremacist and all those people, like Hal Turner, who it turned out was an FBI asset, and I said that on record because I could tell he was one, you know, came out and said, Jones is covering up for the USS Liberty because the admirals I all had on who blew the whistle pointed out that they were ordered to stand down, and the White House was in control of it with Israel to false flag the ship to be able to attack Egypt. I mean, that's a cold-blooded military move. I was covering the real depth of the Liberty, and I had people say, listen, our government wasn't involved in that. It's the Jews. And my thing is, well, let's depoliticize or de-racial this thing or de-religionize. And I'm making up words here, you know, like I'm Jesse Jackson. The point is that let just look at the, how they play us off against each other and then have basic principles of liberty. And then no matter what color we are, what religion, whatever it is, we can all agree these are basic standards that work to build a civilization. Level playing field, free market, you know, exceptionalism, all of these things. But I'm almost out of time, and I got to play a couple news reports here. Again, but let's just for the sake of argument say I'm this horrible person. That shouldn't be used as a crutch for other people to not go out and fight the New World Order. It's easy to come out with a website or a podcast and announce you're great and Alex Jones is bad. It's easy to come out and announce he's a shill, he's this and that, and string stuff together out of context to then announce how big you are. And I am so big that that will get them some limited attention, but not good attention. It's like junk food or something. And so I don't mind being attacked. They've taken it to new heights with my family and stuff. And, you know, everything they do, we just get blessed in the end, so it's up to God. But outside of Alex Jones here, did you have any points you wanted to cover real fast?
Yeah, definitely. I've always, like I said, I'm young, but I've done a lot of looking into a lot of different subjects. I first started looking into you when I found out about the Federal Reserve and just how our whole system has been based off of lies, and it just doesn't make any sense. And when you know, economically, just mathematically, you know, our whole system is just, you know, based off of debt and is literally slavery. And so anyway, that's how I started getting into all of this. And my parents, you know, my mom, you know, totally thinks I'm just ridiculous and that I'm just looking into, you know, wackos, I guess. Which
it's bad to look into things. You don't want to look into things. Well, look, they've tried to flood the internet with wacko weirdness and infighting. That's what Cass Sunstein talked about. And I appreciate your call, sir. They've done that so that people don't know what's real. Okay, well, look, if it's on Infowars.com or PrisonPlanet.com, about 95% of it's accurate. We really try to be accurate. We've got our, you know, serious handle on things. And we give a bibliography of everything we talk about. Okay? I mean, that's what's important. You've got to go make your own decision. But we're trying to find reality. We're trying to be truthful. We're trying to be honorable. But we're fallible, you know, corrupt creatures. We're humans. So it's going to have problems. But we're trying to be real. We're trying to be true blue. And so, you know, that's where it stands or falls. And I've been attacked since day one. Man, the devil must have known what I was going to do early on in my life. Threw everything he had at me, but God took me through it. And 17 years on air, I mean, I think about the stuff I went through the first few years on air. It's nothing even compared to now. And so I'm just going to continue on. We're going to skip this network break here because I've got to go to this piece. And then we're going to come back and go to Simon and then David and Israel. Maybe we shouldn't talk to David and Israel. Israel's so evil. Maybe I'm bad if I even talk to somebody in Israel. I mean, that should be blown off the map, right? I mean, it's wrong to say, to have some Israelis say we need to mow the yard with the Palestinians, which is wrong, and I've said that's wrong. But it's wrong to also have some of the Palestinian Authority people and Ahmadinejad say we want to blow Israel off the map. And by the way, he has basically said that. People say, oh, he didn't really mean that in his quote. He said drive the Zionist state out in the ocean and stuff. But they've also said we're going to blow Israel off the map. Okay, there's a lot of, I don't think the people in Israel have a corner on chutzpah, is my point. And I don't want any war. I want all those cultures to thrive. I want peace. I don't want the crooks to be able to short-circuit society because it gives them power to have wars. You understand that? I want prosperity for everybody because when I want prosperity for you, I get it. And I don't do that like magically. I've learned that in life. I always was like that. I wanted good for other people. And they said, people said, oh, that's foolish. You get ahead by cheating others. Well, that's not what I found. When I die, I want people to know Alex Jones was reputable. He did what he said he would do. He was honorable. He was a good guy. That's why the system, if you notice in their attacks on us, always say we're fraud and we're not real. Because they don't want you to know there's anything real. They don't want you to know there's anything bona fide. Warts and all, I'm real, folks. I don't agree with Jesse Ventura on some things that are fundamental, like abortion. But I still admire him because he is so real and is not controlled. And I know he's come a long way in the 8 years I've known him. And I think in the end, he's going to fully wake up. Okay? So not even the most wise know how everything is going to end up in the end. You just have to go with your heart, go with your soul. Use the intellect to navigate at one level, but your gut and your heart at another. And that's what I have going for me. People that do have discernment, successful people. They know how to read, folks, and they know I'm real. The New World Order knows I'm real. They know I'm ready until death to fight the globalist. I mean, I'm seeking for the truth. I'm seeking for the honorable course. And that's what I'm looking for. That's what I want, because I know it was 5 minutes ago I was 6, 7 years old. It seems like 5 minutes ago. It seems like 30 seconds ago my first child was born. Now he's 10 years old, about to be 11. I know how short this is, and I know that all that lives on is the species. All that lives on is the good guys. And I have hopes and dreams for other people and the love and the passion they're going to have. Even if you don't believe in God and afterlife, I believe in the afterlife of life. I believe in good. All right, let's go to this clip where our own David Knight interviews the House member here in Texas that's leading the charge against the TSA. Here it is.
I don't know about you folks, but I want my freedom and dignity back. You know, the federal government is making it a prerequisite to travel that you have to be subjected to humiliation and sexual assault at the airports. They're taking the right to move about freely, and they're trying to change that into a privilege that's granted only if you submit yourself to unnecessary humiliation. But fortunately, here in Texas, we have some men with some backbone on this issue, and the leader on that is Representative David Simpson from Longview, Texas. Can you tell us a little bit about the bill that you've just put in? It's House Bill 80, I believe?
That's correct. Basically, is we're calling it the Texas Freedom Travel Act. It makes it an offense to touch someone's private part as a condition of getting into an area accessing public transportation or a venue. You have to have probable cause. You have to believe someone's committing a criminal act to treat them as a criminal.
We've basically lost our innocent until proven guilty assumption here. Now we're all guilty until they prove that we're innocent. Is that correct?
That's right. We're continuing to receive assaults on the first 10 amendments, the Bill of Rights, which our founding fathers were very concerned about. And the Fourth Amendment is one in particular that's under assault.
Mm-hmm. Now, this brings up an interesting conflict between the federal government, and we're seeing this on a number of issues. There were a lot of states that passed initiatives that would limit the Obamacare mandate. There were states that passed initiatives on medical marijuana, even marijuana legalization. And we've seen over and over again that the federal government just disregards the wishes of the people and the wishes of the states. They completely disregard the 10th Amendment, just like they do much of the rest of the Constitution. Now, you tried this 2 years ago. Tell us what happened at that time.
Well, the bill received bipartisan support, both chambers. It passed unanimously on both second and third reading. Then the
Department of Justice threatened to make Texas basically a no-fly zone, to shut down a flight or series of flights. And that's just an outrageous threat. We have planes coming in and out of Texas all the time. People are not being searched in this way. And then the bill was brought to the floor after that threat was made, and the initial support that we had, which was nearly every senator, dissipated so that we couldn't overcome the procedural hurdle. But I do believe the people of Texas are behind the bill, and I've received encouraging words from some of the leadership of our state that the bill is going to move quickly, and that's encouraging to me.
Well, that's great. You know, it's not just the people of Texas. There's people all over the country that were watching that last time, and we're supporting you on that. And as you said, it was a total outrage that the federal government would try to blackmail us over that. You know, if you remember 2 years ago around Thanksgiving, right after they'd rolled these machines out, we organized a opt-out campaign for the busiest travel day of the year. And the TSA blinked. They shut the machines down. So, you know, we're coming back this time. 2 years later, we've got an opt-out and film campaign, and this time we're doing it for a week. Because they tried to back down on that. You know, people are fed up with this, and all over the country, people are fed up with this. I really do hope that the Texas legislature, that all of them will get some backbone this time and call their bluff. There's absolutely no way they're going to be able to shut down all travel in and out of Texas.
Well, that's right, and we just should not submit to something that's unconstitutional. We should refuse to give them that right to touch us in that way, unless we've committed a criminal act. And this bill, too, is a little bit improved in that it won't allow TSA or anybody to separate a child from a parent. There was one autistic boy that was separated from his parents. When he was being touched in this intrusive way, he began to cry out, "Man on boy, man on boy." Mm. And just, as a young child who's taught that this is indignant and not supposed to be done can figure this out, why are we allowing our federal government to do this?
Yes.
And we shouldn't go along with it as a state and support it.
That's right. That's right. That's why I said at the beginning, I want my freedom and my dignity back. You know, this is, I think this is just nothing more than just behavioral conditioning. If you look at B.F. Skinner, that's exactly what he was suggesting, telling everybody they have to freeze in the airport. I mean, this is going beyond all reason. This is nothing more than just behavioral control.
That's right, and they're not law enforcement agents. We should refuse to submit to those things. One of my favorite parts of our Texas Constitution is Article 1, Section 1. It says, Texas is a free and independent state, subject only to the United States Constitution. And then it goes on to talk about the importance of local self-government and preserving that. And when it's impaired, it threatens the union. Perpetuity of the union. And so this is critical for not only our state, but for our whole nation, that we do not put up with tyranny.
Yes. Yeah, you probably have noticed these petitions that are going around at the White House. There's 50 petitions in every state saying that they would like to secede.
That's right. And we must refuse as a state to carry out their business for us.
Yes.
One of the programs was Bus Safe in Houston, where they were going to randomly search people's handbags and interrogate them on municipal buses. And what was crazy about it is the Houston PD and our state law enforcement, they would never do that except under the color of the TSA.
Yes.
That doesn't give us any right to not follow the Constitution. We must refuse to follow those that would not uphold the Constitution.
Well, Representative Simpson, I sure appreciate you talking to us. Thank you for taking the lead on this, and we are all watching you to see what happens, and we're all supporting you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David, and thank the people of Texas. They're going to be the ones that move it forward. Thank you so much.
All right, powerful little seven-minute interview, and I'm just doing the rest of the hour live here today. I know we've got Simon in the U.K. holding the longest. Then we've got David in Israel, Celeste in New Mexico, Scanner and Kenny. I will at least get to those calls and hit the economic news. Years ago, I couldn't get it all done in 3 hours. So I went to 4 hours. I went back to three, but we can still do four here. And a lot of stations actually carry the fourth hour. So let's go to Simon in the UK. Then we'll go to David in Israel. Go ahead, Simon. What's on your mind today?
Hi, Alex. What I hope you'll find exciting news. I've been sympathetic with the fact that your electoral system is so inaccessible, but because ours still has the paper ballot, you were talking a lot about that earlier, and I just want to tell you, I've founded a party. You can have six words for a party name. My party is called 9/11 Was an Inside Job.
Oh, that's that'd be a good party, actually. Some polls show 80% of people think it was an inside job here in the U.S. That might be a successful party name.
Well, we found no trouble getting the 10 signatures we needed. I walked down one short street, and we're on the ballot for Parliament for an election taking place on the 29th of November, and I have 58,500 leaflets with 9/11 Was an Inside Job emblazoned on them going into every home in this constituency. If I could just give you the URL, if anybody wants to see that leaflet, it's a short URL. And
sir, this is genius. Another way to get the word out. Sure, give it to us.
Thank you. I knew you'd like it, man. It's inspired by your great work, my friend. NEWAIJ, 9/11 Was an Inside Job, the initials, NEWAIJ.org. And you can look at our leaflet there. And if anybody wants to join, I'm taking members worldwide. This is a worldwide movement to try and get...
Yeah, give that out again. I want to write that down so we can put it up on screen.
Please. I'd love, if Paul Joseph Watson or somebody in the UK wants to get hold, I can offer you exclusive coverage of the events leading up to this. It's going to be...
No, but that's a smart way. And everybody getting the breakdown of the parties will see that. Smart little loophole you found there. What's the name of the site again?
It's just the initials of 9/11 as words, NEWAIJ. 9/11 Was an Inside Job, NEWAIJ.org.
NEWNIJ.org.
It kind of spells New Age, but don't worry, we're nothing to do with...
Whatever. The point is, this is getting the word out. Very exciting. Anything else you'd like to add?
Yeah, I mean, one thing is that the media here is required to mention the names of all parties. And another trick here is that we can stand in local elections with no deposit. There's some expense involved for a parliamentary election, but people can stand. Anybody who wants to stand is prepared to put the time in going around knocking on doors. We can get it on a ballot.
And then you get to go around to all the meetings and debates and get in the news.
Yep.
Even if the elections are fraudulent here to a great extent, it's great to run because you then get to illustrate things to people, and it's another bully pulpit to use. We'll be back with a call from Israel and New Mexico, Florida, West Virginia, you name it, and a key report on the economy. Back live, ladies and gentlemen, as we are Monday through Friday, 12 noon to 3 p.m. Eastern, and I am the long-winded progenitor of extremism, as Media Matters and other globalist operatives would say. But we are here live. The websites are prisonplanet.com. We're streaming video at prisonplanet.tv. And we also have the big flagship site, infowars.com, with some other auxiliaries out there like whatistheendgame.com and things like that. Okay, here's the deal. I'm going to take three or four more calls, and then I've got to get to the financial news, some of the military news, and a few other big tidbits. We have not, they're not even tidbits, they're huge. I mean, 6 years ago, they would deny the NSA spy without warrants. Now, Senate bill rewrite lets feds read your email without warrants. We know that's already going on, but I mean, now they just admit it. That's CNET News. It's just, it's unending. And there's people out there, oh, don't worry about it. It's no big deal. When we have the most scientifically crafted, grasping, premeditatedly evil government that's run by a bunch of mad scientists that think they're elites and see us as animals. And let me tell you something. I'm not an animal. And I've been around, I've seen a lot of things, and I've researched your writings, and I've watched you. And you people are not elitist. What you are is a stinking case of cancer. And I guess in your argument, hey, if you can take something over, that means you're boss of it. Not in my book. Not in my book. I mean, that's like these crazy people. They ask him, why'd you throw your baby off the cliff? I just had a compulsion. I just knew I could. I forget what they call that in psychology. But, man, I tell you, I'm not drinking the Kool-Aid here. It's that simple. And we're in trouble. We're in trouble. We better turn this around. And that means all of us ourselves. Get our lives together. Get our houses in order. And so much of this is driven just by habit. We've been brought up in this corruption. We're just so used to it. Question everything. All right, let's go to your calls. Let's talk to David in Israel. David, what did you call in about today?
I'm calling about that, you know, that there was a ceasefire that was supposed to happen. It was announced. It was on the news at 9 p.m. Israel time, which is 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And it just, Israel stopped, and the Arabs and Palestinians are still shooting rockets. They never stopped. I started seeing things on my Facebook page from it, and then also on Arut Sheva, you know, which is Israel nationalnews.com, also mentioned it. Like, it's in some of the news things here. So, you know, all the, even like Fox and all the news, it says ceasefire announced, and they kind of, that's it.
But well, I mean, obviously, the image of Israel with F-16s bombing government buildings in Gaza is one we don't like to see, and I understand that. But why does Hamas, quote, celebrate Tel Aviv bus bombing? And I went and looked it up. They actually said that. Dozens wounded in blasts. Hamas blesses attack. Says, God willing, we will soon see black body bags. DrudgeReport.com is the best listing of all this. Egypt is calling this a truce. So my only issue is, why did they start firing rockets in early October? And why does everybody, because again, I'm about logic. I'm about being fair here. And I see a lot of stuff done in Israel I don't like. I see a lot of stuff a lot of other places that I don't like. My only issue is I don't understand why Hamas is doing this if they don't want to be bombed. Can you explain that to me?
Sure, because they want to just destroy Israel. It's kind of like the kamikaze pilots. Like, you know, America couldn't handle it in the beginning because they couldn't understand it. So, you know, they just want it, and it's written, you know, in their Bible, in the Quran. They just want to destroy all non-believers, and they know they're going to get attacked. They want to, which is hard for people to understand, they want to get a higher death toll, because they know it gets on the news. Like, a rocket recently hit a school in southern Israel, but that school was empty because they sent everyone home for the day. Over there, they want to have the kids in school so they can go on the news and say, look at the
poor baby. No, that's true. They actually parked the schools right next to the missiles.
Correct. But even now, like, the example is there's a ceasefire, Israel stops, and they're continuing to shoot rockets. So what's going to happen? Israel will go back in again and take some type of military action. And then people are going to say, oh, gee, what happened? It's a crazy circle. But, like, they literally never stopped. It was supposed to be 9 p.m., and I'm seeing things on Facebook.
No, I know. That's my point. You know, my point is I'm tempted to go there and see this for myself, but then I need to go see it from the other perspective. But I don't say I'm neutral on this because that's a good position to take. I mean, I live here in the United States. I'm on record not liking Israel, you know, involved in our politics, but I get the fact that they want that for their interest. That's what governments do. That's why the Constitution says that shouldn't be happening. But then I also get that the other Arab countries won't let the Palestinians into their countries. And then I also see the fact that, you know, there is all this talk. It's like, well, I'm over here trying to not have an Iran war because the government will use that to take my liberties and it'll kill a lot of innocent Iranians who don't like their government. But at the same time, Ahmadinejad is saying, blow up Israel, wipe them off the face. So it's so crazy when it just goes on and on. And I'll say this. Let me ask you this as somebody living in Israel. Yes, you're an Israeli, obviously. Let me ask you this question. We'll open the phones up because the show's almost over. On Friday and then Sunday, I'm going to be live on Sunday and then Monday because I want to get both sides from you know, Palestine areas of, you know, Gaza, wherever folks are at there, to call them, but also from Israel. Because why did the West put Al Qaeda in Libya, put them in Syria, now put the Muslim Brotherhood in, kick out their old guy? I mean, I see what's happening. They're getting ready to get just a big war going because then they can have more weapon sales on both sides and politicians can point fingers at each other. I mean, I see that that's why this is going on. And I quite frankly see, you know, Hamas gets stronger the more they're attacked. Netanyahu will get reelected because he's standing up to it. Boy, war just seems to help government, doesn't it?
Well, it's not really about the government so much. The Islamic way is to destroy anyone in the West. So I think the rest of the governments pulling out Mubarak and putting in the Muslim Brotherhood, it makes no sense. But I see it as a situation where they want to maybe appease them because they're afraid of being attacked themselves. So it's like, hey, we'll give them Czechoslovakia. We'll, you know, give this over. Just leave us alone.
Yeah, here, Hitler, we'll give you Poland. Everything's fine. Well, sure. I mean, they have the saying that when freedom fails, the best men rot in filthy jails, and those that cry to appease are hung by those they tried to please.
Yes. And what you were saying before about the Native Americans is good. Just give you a background perspective, basic perspective. Jerusalem has been the capital of Israel for 3,000 years. There's been continuous Jewish presence here for 3,000 years. It's probably one of the oldest cities in the world, older than London, older than Paris. And if you go to the Western Wall, what we call here the Kotel, you can see from the outer walls of the Second Temple that's thousands of years old. Islam didn't even exist till 1,300 years ago. So it's been a continuous Jewish presence here, and there's about 6 million Jewish people in the Middle East. There's 600 million Arabs and Muslims. It's a 100-to-1 ratio, and the land is 1,000-to-1. If you look at the Muslim and Arab
land. No, I know those numbers. My only issue is this. I have had groups connected to the Israel lobby attack me because I'm against the whole globalist move because all these governments are lined up for it. But then I separately, viciously, and sustained, before I ever even got into these issues, have been attacked by groups that all they do is obsess on Israel. If someone falls on a banana peel, it's Israel's fault. Everyone that works for me supposedly works for Israel. I get orders from Israel, all of it totally made up. They'll even edit that together. It's like, I've never seen so much deception as my point, is that I'm not somebody that's a joiner or in this camp or that camp, and it just must be really weird if you're Jewish, or especially Israeli, to have the whole world 24-7 obsessed with you, when, like you said, you're 1% over there in that area. I mean, it is biblical. It is, and of course there's going to be wickedness in high places. You're going to have wickedness in Israel as well. It is bizarre. It really is the big enchilada. Real quick closing comment to that, and then I'm going to take a few more calls.
Sure. I think any criticism you have of Israel is legitimate or fair, even if I disagree with it. You're coming from a normalized place, not in a demonizing way. So I will say that, even if things I disagree with, it's...
Well, my whole point is everybody's got problems and corruptions. It's systemic. I'm just saying, I know in the Arab world, demonization of Israel becomes just an easy one-off for everything. Because I personally have experienced it, because I don't even hardly get into Israel and all this. I try to stay out of it, and people demand to put you in a camp is what I'm saying.
Correct, yes. Absolutely. You don't necessarily need to be in one. Necessarily, and people, it's like I said, it's not about picking like sports teams, one or the other. But one closing point, like I said, just keep in mind that anything going forward, that Israel stopped with the ceasefire and the Arabs did not. So if anything happens tomorrow or the next day, the news is not going to necessarily report that the ceasefire, the Arabs was continuing to shoot rockets when Israel stopped. And again, you can go to IsraelNationalNews.com, you can see it. There are things out there, but it's not widely publicized. So if Israel does something, we do something in the next day or two or tonight or something else, you'll know the reason for this specific issue. There was a ceasefire. They did not hold. We will do something. It's not what happened? It'll be clear. So just, keep that in mind for, what comes up in the next.
Sure. Well, here's the headline out of the LA Times. Ceasefire between Israel and Hamas prevents ground war. But Egypt says Gaza's ceasefire agreement reached, and I'm not denying what you're saying, but I'm not even seeing more rockets fired. If what you're saying is true, then it shows that the media is involved in a cover-up of this, because let me just type in rockets.
Click on IsraelNationalNews.com, right, which is a root sheva, and then...
Oh, here it is, ABC News, yeah. No. I found it. It's rockets fall silent in Gaza ceasefire between Israel and Hamas. Wait. The headline said that it had rocket fire halts. That says that. It lists 116 rocket strikes. Gaza rockets from Iran's technology. Iran. I believe you. I'll go check it. But we'll follow that. I appreciate your call from Israel. Look, my whole issue is, ladies and gentlemen, this is my biggest criticism of Israel. The Israel lobby consistently is anti-Second Amendment in this country, while my taxpayer money pays for settlers' M16s. And I mean, my goodness, I'm going to pay for your M16s, but I can't have one? You know, that's my issue. And we wouldn't be over there in the Middle East if it wasn't for all the oil. Our government's putting Al-Qaeda in. It makes perfect sense because they're going to have larger wars with all these countries, and the globalists do want to depopulate the Arabs. I'd rather empower the Arabs, industrialize them, but the West since 53 has been overthrowing these countries. Anyways, it's a complex issue. It's just, yes, Hamas, since October 1st, has been firing rockets every day into Israel. To get the response, to get the crisis going, to try to force other Arab nations into a conflict with Israel. And Israel has got hundreds of nuclear weapons and a high-tech military, and you know the U.S. is going to get pulled in. I'm just trying to stop a wider war that the globalists are going to use to take all our liberties. And, you know, it is not good that they're firing rockets into Israel. And they're getting more and more high-tech. And the politicians' approval ratings drop when they don't fight back against that. So they're going to fight back against it. And, you know, government stage stuff, too. They don't even have to with this stuff. It's very complex. People want to make it simple. Celeste in New Mexico, you're on the air. Thanks for holding.
Hi, Alex. I just wanted to call and wish you a wonderful, blessed Thanksgiving and your family and all your crew.
Thank you.
You know, when we hear about all the things going on, we know that the Prince of Peace is in control. And I just want to call all of our brothers and sisters all over the world to join most Americans tomorrow. We're going to be sitting down and thanking God for all the wonderful things he's given us, and to join us and to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And that's what the Word tells us. And there is hope. We know we win in the end. So I just want to encourage you, Alex. We've been listening to you since you went on the air 17 years ago. You're like part of our family, and we are just so blessed by you and thankful. And just keep up the good work.
Well, thank you. You know, I tried to sit down this morning and write up something. In fact, I have some notes over here about what I'm thankful for, and it's such a big issue that I started almost crying, you know, got a tear in my eye. I don't even know how to say to God how thankful I am. I mean, it's so good. Goodness is so good. And then it makes evil that much more abhorrent. And that's why we have to stand up against it every day, every way. And I'm just thankful for our great audience who takes action. I'm thankful to all our friends in the media and the alternative media that are helping us fight tyranny. It is such a blessing and a great honor that we can now call for a national opt-out, film the TSA, and it's one of the biggest stories in the country. We can now expose RFID with kids getting kicked out of school. It's now a national news story. We can now expose so many things because we're now on over 140 AM and FM stations. Our news websites are giant. DrudgeReport.com carries a lot of it. That's what pushes it over the edge, along with all the other things. I'm just thankful for everybody. And I just want us to rediscover our common sense and rediscover a natural distrust of big government and a natural, you know, I mean, nobody wants to give you something for free from a big system, folks. People want to help somebody that's down, but the system doesn't want to help you. They want to help destroy you. Anything else, ma'am?
I just want to say it was a blessing to hear your son. You know, that's our hope, the young man from Florida. You know, we've got a lot of things to be thankful for. We've got young people, good young people, and we need to stand up. And Jesus said, the truth will set us free. And that's what we're about. And thank God for you, and just keep up the fight.
Thank you so much. God bless you. Yeah, I see sitcoms and dramas that have paid government messages. You understand that's admitted. That's not a free system. They've got that overlaying the real media. They want to get rid of us, so they're unopposed. And they're foolish. They think that'll work because the message has been sent. The more they clamp down, the more it's self-evident. But they have pro-government healthcare messages, anti-gun messages, anti-family messages. And they've got messages that are anti-children, that children are horrible and gross and a burden. And they've got messages that are destructive. And that's government paid for. And we're told young people are crud, and they do act like crud. More than ever, I've seen the numbers. But those that are awake are better than ever. It's just kind of a splitting apart of the ways there. the wheat from the chaff. But expanding on that, you should have an instinct to want to empower youth and empower others and teach them your knowledge and teach others what you know. That's what civilization and humankind is based on. Final segment, straight ahead. We'll try to go to Kenny and Kara and others. We'll be right back. There is an amazing article by Kurt Nemo up at Infowars.com. The United Nations is now moving with internal injunctions in the United States to block state laws nullifying legalization, decriminalization of marijuana. Unbelievable, because there's international treaties. See, this is global government right here. The states, they're saying, have no. Why do we even have states? Why is the UN and NATO telling Congress they tell the president who to attack? I mean, we're in global government. What we told you about 17 years ago is coming true. You better tell everybody you know about this broadcast. Unbelievable. And that story's been out for like an hour and a half, and I haven't even covered it. That's how conditioned I am to just accept this because I live so close to it. See, that's a problem. It's not that you can be too awake, but I'm already expecting all this. That article's up at Infowars.com. I mean, this is global government in your face. Good job, Kurt Nemo, on that. Countdown to Judgment Day, breaking down the total surveillance takeover. Melissa Melton, father blames TSA for incident which left baby bleeding. Oh, my gosh. Off the charts. TSA reissues order for software to spy on employees' communications. TSA refuses to release secret Obama directive on cybersecurity. NSA, I called it TSA. Cameras inside, mannequins spying on shoppers. I mean, just unbelievable. Journalists threatened by TSA pin scathing response. That's all up at prisonplanet.com or infowars.com. And now they are going to make it nearly impossible to pass on a farm or a business to your children. Let's say you got a 100-acre farm. Sounds big to folks. You can barely make money with a 100-acre farm because the profit's so small on whatever you grow. And you got all the... Well, I'm not going to get into the whole story. The point is, they've done the actuaries, and it's broken down in the article. And I have family that have had to sell farms when they're dying because they go, oh, well, this is 200 acres. This is 100 acres. Why, we're going to value that at $6 million. There might be somebody that would buy that. Why, there was property 10 miles from here that sold for that. Yeah, because it's by a highway or whatever. And then they say, okay, you got to pay 50% inheritance tax. And now it's going up. Well, I don't have $3 million. Well, you got to sell it then. And then sometimes they'll come back and say, well, you didn't sell it for enough. Well, you owe even more. It's like a penalty to even have the land. Do you know what they called the property tax when William the Conqueror put it in over England? They called it the doomsday tax. I almost interrupted Joseph Farah when he brought up the doomsday is coming with all the taxes. And I almost went, but I didn't interrupt him. I controlled myself. I'm like a little kid when somebody says something I want to add to it, I'm like, listen, I'm sorry. I don't have time to go to your other calls. I got to most of them, but I'll be back, Lord willing. We got to rebroadcast tomorrow. We got to go decide what rebroadcast to put together, something special for tomorrow. And then Mike Adams is in on Friday. I think I do need a rest, but you know me, I won't be resting. I'll probably shoot 10 videos from home, knowing me. And then I'll be back Sunday. We'll be live Sunday, 4 to 6 p.m. Central, here on the air and all new InfoWars Nightly News next Monday. And we're just following this incredible national opt-out, film the TSA. On record, they're trying to break your will and train you with obedience training and teach you that you're a prisoner, teach you that you're a perpetrator, teach you that you're all suspects, guilty until proven New World Order slave, guilty until they put you 6 feet under, guilty until they've destroyed you. Now they're taking the kids away to private rooms where the salivating pedos literally drag them screaming and crying. But we're fighting back. And we're exposing that the government ran the attacks of 9/11, and we're exposing the globalists and the government runs Al-Qaeda. Their whole narrative will fall if we just expose it and if we stand up for what's right. We have a future. I'm thankful to the crew, our sponsors, our listeners, our AM and FM affiliates. Nothing without God and His Son, Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior. and just all of you out there, we're going to be able to defeat the globalists if we're proud of liberty and if we stand up for it and if we challenge globalist henpecking control freaks everywhere. They desire to dominate. We desire freedom. And if we're going to have any freedom, we've got to stand up against them.
GCN. Visit GCN.